here at Mountaineer Field, and with Miami having fallen from among the mighty and a shaky start by Syracuse, the pundits have pounded the Big East this season, perhaps overlooking the two teams meeting here in what is being billed as the showdown in Motown. And that's Morgantown, to those of you unfamiliar with the home of the Mountaineers. Now, both these teams are 5-1. Virginia Tech is 4-0 in the Big East. A victory here today could separate them from both West Virginia and Syracuse, and a third straight Alliance Bowl appearance awaits. I'm joined by Mike Mayock, and we have two very well-matched football teams meeting here today.
Yeah, we really do, Tim. The talent level is very similar, and these two teams are really mirror images of each other. So what will separate these two teams today? Well, number one, who protects the football? Virginia Tech has the least number of turnovers in the country with 5. West Virginia's right behind them at number 7. Special teams at number 2. Whoever wins the battle for field position will have a huge leg up in a ball control game. And lastly, it's no secret that both teams want to run the football with their marquee tailbacks. And for Virginia Tech, that means Ken Oxendine. He's the only back to have gained 100 yards against West Virginia last year, and he followed that up with a 150-yard performance against Nebraska in the Orange Bowl. And for West Virginia, well, it's famous Amos Zaraway. He leads the Big East with 149 yards rushing per game. And Tim, he's got a running style fairly reminiscent of the great one from the Detroit Lions, Barry Sanders.
Yes, and that's his self-proclaimed idol. He likes that guy, and he grew up built somewhat like Barry Sanders and tried to emulate that great NFL star. The weather here today is overcast skies. It rained all day yesterday, part of the night. 52 degrees the temperatures. They have the lights on at Mountaineer Field. 50% chance of rain. Doesn't feel like that right now, and hopefully it'll stay dry. Virginia Tech won the toss and deferred, so West Virginia will be the receiving team for the opening kickoff. Curtis Keaton and Nate Terry are the deep return men. These teams have been playing since 1912, when Tech won at 41-0 in that game, and West Virginia leads the series, however, over the years. But in recent years, it's been Tech. Nate Terry, from inside the 5, tripped up at about the 15-yard line, and it was Ike Charlton getting down to make the tackle, number 3. Backup secondary man. And also their kick return. Mark Bulger will lead out the West Virginia Mountaineers. The sophomore, 190-pounder from Pittsburgh, where at his high school, he was called the second coming of Dan Marino.
And that may be a little unfair to anybody, Tim.
I think so. We asked him that yesterday. He said, you know, I try not to think about it at all. I'm Mark Bulger, and Marino's a great quarterback and a long way from reaching his feet. On first down, he wants to throw. Quick shot out into the flat. A gain of about 3, Deshaun Foreman. Good coverage by the Hokies. Looking at the backs and receivers for West Virginia. Famous Amos Zaraway. Leroy White is the fullback. Tight end is Chad Wable, and the wide receivers Sean Foreman and Corey Ivey. Of course, they have the injured David Saunders on the sideline for the season. Solomon Page, Randy Dunnigan, Eric DeGro, Brian Pukenis, and Sam Austin, an experienced front for West Virginia. And the Hokies stuffed that attempt by Zaraway, his first carry. No gain, if any, maybe a loss on the play. Defensively, for the Hokies of Virginia Tech, a four-man front, Engelberger, Hairston, Bradley, and Wheel. The linebackers, Corey Bird for the injured Corey Irby, Steve Tate in the middle, and Jamel Smith very active on his side. The secondary, Johnson, Carpenter, Prelo, and Anthony Midget. Three wide receivers in on third down. Bulger has a man open. That is Pat Green. And a first down to the Mountaineers.
Good call by Dan Simrell, the offensive coordinator. Three-step drop, quick slant into Green. He just protects the football and the first down. And Tim, what I like about the series so far, we highlighted tailbacks, but I really believe the quarterback that steps up and make the plays today is going to make the difference in the ball game. That will allow the tailback to be more effective later.
First down for Mark Bulger and the Mountaineers at their own 28-yard line. Opening up offensive series. Zeroway dances his way for about four, maybe five. Keon Carpenter came up from the secondary, and Hairston, the right tackle, getting a piece of him on the way.
That was Amos's favorite play. We asked him yesterday what he liked. He said, hey, Statue of Liberty and sprint draw. And that was their a good look at the sprint draw play.
It'll be second and six. West Virginia, we're just underway at Mountaineer Field. Sellout crowd, 63,500. Zeroway again, a couple of more. Trelo comes up from the safety spot. He's the rover in this defense of Virginia Tech, a very active player. And he kept saying to us, talking to him the other day, we must be alert, alert, alert.
Yeah, he's really one of the keys. Watch him chase down from the far side. He's going to come all the way across right here and make the play to the front side. He checks bootleg, and now he's got the speed to catch Zeroway from behind. That's an excellent play by the leader of that secondary, Pearson Prelo.
And a sample of the rover roving all over the place. He was almost lined up at the defensive end on the play. Third down. Here you go for a first. Zeroway spins away from one tackler, but he's racked up short of the yardage needed for a first. Prelo came up again, and Tate, the middle linebacker, making the initial contact.
It shows you the confidence they have in the run game. That was third and a long three, almost four, and they still went with Amos. The isolation play, and a good job by Tate, the walk-on middle linebacker.
Ryan Bauman takes one practice swing with his right leg. He'll be punting, standing at the 23-yard line. Angelo Harrison is back. Bauman, a short punt, and a flag down near where the punt took place. The ball rolls to the 27-yard line of Virginia Tech, but a flag down near the punter.
Yeah, it was one of the up men on a hold. A very obvious call right in front of the referee.
36-yard punt, but this one could come back. That will not make Don Nealon happy, head coach of the Mountaineers.
They've had a lot of problems punt protection going back a year ago. They were 7-0. All they had to do was protect their punter on the last play of the game against Miami, and it got blocked for a touchdown. And then they had two blocked the following week.
Holding. Offense. 10 yards. Spotted a foul. Replay fourth down. R.G. Detillier makes the call, his first of the day, and now Bauman standing at his 6-yard line. A little frustrated there at something. You saw his expression with his hands.
Those punters get more nervous the closer they get to their own end zones.
With good cause. And here comes the rush. Bauman, again, another short kick. He just didn't get it. It goes out at the 43-yard line of the Mountaineers. So Virginia Tech benefits from the penalty, and they have excellent field position for their first possession.
Well, under Frank Beamer, Virginia Tech has blocked 55 kicks in 120 games. Watch Keon Carpenter, and what happens is Barrett Green's got to come over and grab a handful of his jersey to keep the punt from being blocked. Now, you hate to see the holding penalty, but that does prevent a block kick. But what it does give Virginia Tech now is excellent field position at the 47-yard line.
Keon Carpenter accounted for three of Tech's five block punts last season, so he knows how to get there to that football. And he was nearly there again this time. First down at the 43-yard line. First possession, Hokies, opening period. Here in Morgantown. Alcock will throw on first down, and he connects to Harrison, Angelo Harrison, number 83, the junior from Spotsylvania, Virginia. Al Clark, the 6'1 junior, taking over from the outstanding Jim Druckenmiller, All-American now with the 49ers. He's a junior from Washington, D.C., passing at 60% with six touchdowns and only one interception. His last outing against B.C., threw the ball only 12 times, was 7 of 12 for 125 yards and a touchdown. But he also ran to a score in that game, 42 yards out. Second down and about a yard and a half. Marcus Parker, ball carrier. And
He'll be close to the first down. See how they mark it. Let's take a look at the backs and receivers. Oxendine and Parker, the running backs. Sean Sullivan, the tight end. Michael Stewie and Angelo Harrison. Remember, they are without Sean Scales, out with an ankle tendon injury. Derek Smith, Dwight Beck, Todd Washington, Gennaro DiNapoli, outstanding senior at right guard, and Brad Baylor, a converted defensive tackle, never played on the offensive side of the line, and he has adapted very well to the right tackle spot. Requiring a measurement, and they have it. Defensively for West Virginia, they were number one in the nation in this department last year. Across their three-man front, Baum, Thornton, and Henry Slay, an outstanding defensive end. Stills, keep an eye on number 55, Jamie Sweeney, who had a scope on his knee just 10 days ago, returns to start with Hadley and Cogdell. Bastien, Green, Tompkins, and Terry, the secondary. First down at the 28-yard line of West Virginia. Clark is swarmed under and sacked. Stills, we said keep an eye on him. Hope you did.
Here's a guy with only one arm. An explosive pass rusher off the edge. Here we go, right here, working on the right tackle. Watch him clear the explosiveness. An incredible play, just an arm under, left arm with the big cast on it, grabs Al Clark, and that's a guy that can make plays happen off the edge, the rush linebacker for West Virginia.
9 yard loss, second and 19, the crowd alive at Mountaineer Field. Oxendine straight ahead on a little draw play. Mountaineers didn't buy it, but he battles his way for about four. Inside the 40 to the 39. Thornton, the nose tackle. And linebacker John Hadley there to stop him.
Play selection very interesting for Virginia Tech. As our Craig James said in the pregame show, he expected to see play action. We've already seen play action twice so far, plus the option thrown in.
They give him a 3 yard pickup, third and 16. Fullback Parker, and Parker stumbled as he had to reach back for the ball and is short of the first down at the 34-yard line.
Virginia has one of the most diverse defenses in the country. They throw the whole kitchen sink. They've got zone blitz. They've got nickel. They've got dime. Steve Dunlop spends an awful lot of time. You see him right there in the middle at Three Rivers Stadium, and they do pretty much everything the Pittsburgh Steelers do. So, Tim, if you see the Pittsburgh Steelers on Monday night do something new, Steve Dunlop's going to have it in Morgantown by Saturday.
Well, they're just up the road, about an hour away. Field goal attempt from 51 yards, Shane Graham. And that is no good. Wide to the right for Graham from 51 yards away. So we are still scoreless in the first period in Morgantown.
Well, one of the things we're going to see a lot of today is naked bootleg and play action. What happens is when you've got a great tailback, the defense flows, and watch Chad Wavell, the tight end, clear when the free safety jumps all over the play action fake. Everybody wants to tackle their way. They run up. Look at Chad Wavell, wide open, and that's like stealing. And that's the one dimension that's been added to this West Virginia offense this year is balance, and you'll see that today.
So Shane Graham attempting a 51-yard field goal attempt after the short punt from West Virginia, but missing wide right. That's his first try over 50 yards this year and only second in his college career. And it looked like he had the leg, but he was a little wide to the right. So it is first down, the Mountaineers, starting from their own 34. Bulger, and it is broken up. Keon Carpenter, I believe, got his hand on the ball. Lauren Johnson there with Carpenter on the coverage.
It's an excellent job by Carpenter, the free safety, reacting late, getting underneath the post cut, helping Lauren Johnson. And look, him elevate, almost catches the football. That's a great job. He's thinking run support, but then he runs underneath the post cut, turns in time, and almost makes the interception.
Intended for Corey Ivey. You saw Johnson trying to get that rebound, but it was just an incomplete pass, second and 10. turf here, artificial turf, a little bit greasy because of the rain overnight and all day yesterday. They did have the blowers and dryers out there to suck up the extra water, but it looked like he slipped there on slippery turf.
Key there really is the block by the wide receiver Corey Ivey. Watch him stay on the edge. He's going to get the contain man, that's Pearson Plalo, and keep fighting him and push off. That allows Arroway up the inside of him, and if Amos keeps his feet, he might still be running right now.
It leaves a third and two, West Virginia. Ball at their own 42-yard line. Bulger has a man open, the tight end, Wable. Chad Wable, first down at the Tech 34-yard line. Jamel Smith made the tackle, and you saw Bulger roll out on that naked bootleg play. We're going to see it again.
Exactly what we talked about. Everybody wants to tackle Zeroway. No guard in front. That's why it's called naked. And Chad Wable wide open. No free safety in the hole. And that's the added dimension to this West Virginia offense this year. Great play action because of the tailback and that man, Mark Bulger.
24-yard gain, and they are now 14 of 14 on that play this season. Even though the teams are expecting it and looking at tape, they can't stop it. That's incomplete. Bulger out to Green, Pat Green. He was hit just as he made contact with the football. And, of course, the fans hear what an interference call.
There's a surprise. You know, that play action, that naked bootleg is so difficult. I can tell you as an ex-defensive back that it puts so much pressure on the linebackers in secondary. When you've got a back like Zeroway, everybody's trying to fly to the football. And then when you put it in his stomach and pull it back out again, you've got to react back in coverage. And, man, that's brutal.
Well, it's a good misdirection play, and they make it look very good, even though, you know, Bulger has every opportunity to turn back the other way. Inside handoff. That's the fullback, Leroy White, driving. And gets close to a first down. For an update, let's go to Jim Nance in New York.
All right, Tim, they call this Stillwater, Oklahoma, but things are really percolating right now because Oklahoma State's come back from a 30-7 deficit, 30 unanswered. Tony Lindsay, three touchdown passes, 150 to go in that game. Let's go back to Tim and Mike.
Wow.
That's a rivalry, Oklahoma in Missouri. Third and two here. 47-yard line. West Virginia. Zeroway stopped by Engelberger, and again, it's very close to the first down yardage. Let's see while they unpile here.
Refs, when the refs give you that look, it means it's fourth down. They're not even going to measure unless West Virginia asks for one.
Well, it's inside that 25-yard line, outside, I should say, and therefore inside the first down marker. So it is fourth down, and the kicker comes onto the field for Don Nealon's Mountaineers. Jay Taylor, number 47, will be attempting just inside the 35-yard line.
Fans want them to go for it, fourth and less than one.
Brewers 5 of 7 in this department, and now make it 6 of 8, and the first points are on the board. The home team, Mountaineers, 3-0. A 44-yard field goal by Jay Taylor has West Virginia on top, 3-0. Let's go down to our sidelines and reporter Dave Logan.
All right, thank you very much, Tim. One of the big factors in this game is going to be West Virginia's standout, Gary Stills. Now, you've already seen him play with this kind of cast on because of the dislocation to the left thumb. Now, that may present a problem to him when he wants to get down in a three-point stance, when he wants to wrap up a ball carrier. But as Mike Mayock already alluded to, he said he would play with one arm if he had to. He's doing a great job this afternoon. Tim.
Thank you, David. Well, you know, Gary Stills, a junior from Trenton, New Jersey, also has been bothered with a neck injury and a knee injury, and it seems like nothing's going to slow him down. He burst in there in the very opening defensive play of the game to make the set. Kickoff short. Taken inside the 30. Andre Kendrick. And got back close to the 35-yard line of Virginia Tech.
Just moments ago, after the field goal, look at Frank Beamer. He doesn't usually get upset. Now, I think he feels like one of his guys got cut. He's pointing at Johnson in the knee, and there's been a lot of bad blood between Blacksburg and Motown this week because there were some words exchanged about whether or not Virginia Tech was a dirty club, and I think Frank Dean is reacting to that.
On first down, the Hokies are trying to get it going, and that's Marcus Parker, the fullback. That may be a yard.
Henry Slay made the tackle on him. Well, we've been talking about Morgantown, and Mike Mayock mentioned Blacksburg. You can see Blacksburg just over the border in the state of Virginia, Morgantown up near the Pennsylvania border. And Morgantown just about an hour's drive south of Pittsburgh. Depending on traffic, if you're trying to get to the football game in Morgantown, you better allow about 4 hours.
I think Blacksburg's closer drive time than Pittsburgh is, from what we've seen.
Second down and nine, the Hokies in white to our left. Inside, hitting down to Oxendine. Oxendine met right at the line of scrimmage. Muscles his way for maybe two.
Oxendine last week carried 33 times, 2 weeks ago, I should say. They're coming off an off week, as are the Mountaineers. But against Boston College, he picked up 122 yards, but he had to carry the ball 33 times. That's the most ever for him.
Yeah, I think we're going to see a more diverse attack today than we did against Boston College.
Third and seven from the shotgun. Al Clark is 2 for 2 passing. And there's flags at the line of scrimmage. Somebody may have moved.
Yeah, I think the right side of that Virginia Tech, it might have been Brad Baylor. I think he picked his hand up. And once your hand goes below your knees as an offensive lineman, you cannot move it.
Brad Baylor is that former defensive tackle. Converted to offense.
Prior to the snap, false start, offense, 5 yards. Still third down.
There's Brad Baylor. We talked to Gennaro DiNapoli about him. He said he's been playing awfully well for a former DT.
Yeah, he's playing well, but this is a tough thing. There he is on the end of the line. When you're used to being the aggressor, it's tough to stand back like that. And there he rocks on the stance, good call. And when you've got Gary Stills on the edge, you know you're trying to rock back and give yourself a chance to block him.
Finds a man. Oxendine can't hold on.
Had to reach back for it. And again, with a little slippery turf, he couldn't get good footing to reach back, and he dropped the ball. So Tech will have to punt. And Stills pumped up.
They double-teamed him that time. They ran a little stunt to try and get Stills inside. Watch what he's going to come around here, and he's going to get picked up by two Virginia Tech offensive linemen. He takes, there's the stunt. He comes inside. Look at him. DiNapoli and Washington, the two best linemen. 2-on-1 on Stills, and that's what you've got to do to take him out of the football game.
Jimmy Kibble will punt for Tech. He just got it away at the 25-yard line. And the punt rolls inside the five, down there by Tech. What a job by Kibble.
I thought Nate Terry should have caught the football, landed on the 10-yard line.
Lauren Johnson downed it at the 2 of West Virginia.
I mean, the cardinal rule there is you put your heels on the 10-yard line and catch the football. Now, let's take a look. It's almost blocked, a little bit of a high snap. Kibble gets it away quickly. They're not going to call it there, incidental contact. Kibble's a theater major, probably. Look where the ball hits. It hits on the 10-yard line. If you catch the football, you save yourself 8 yards, and more importantly, your offense is not backed up in their own end zone.
That's 7 times he's gotten it inside the opposition's 15-yard line this season.
Doing a great job. From the end zone, Bulger, deep sideline is complete. Corey Ivey, the sophomore from Boca Raton, Florida. Fine pass from the sophomore, Bulger, a 19-yard gain.
And that's called a wheel route. What it means is a little bit of an out-and-up route by the inside receiver. What he's going to do is come down and come up the field, and this guy will curl to the inside. It's a great read by Bulger on the wheel route. There's the out cut. He pump fakes it, and the turn up, he gets the man-to-man coverage he wants. And what a touch pass by Bulger. Excellent call inside their own five.
First down at the 21. Play action. It's complete off the left side to Foreman. John Foreman, the wide receiver from Chesapeake, Virginia. He's a junior. Larry Green had the coverage. Number 11.
You know, Tim, I really like the play calling so far by Dan Simrell. And the reason I like it is because first down, they're doing a lot of play action pass when Virginia Tech's expecting run. I think later in the game, that's going to open up Amos their way.
And similarly, offensive coordinator for West Virginia leaves a second and two. High formation this time, in motion behind the ball goes Corey Ivey. Straight ahead, the fullback Leroy White. Senior is met at the line of scrimmage. For another update, let's go to Jim Nance in New York.
All right, Tim, just seconds to go. Oklahoma State with a 7-point lead, and Missouri's quarterback Corby Jones throws his fourth touchdown pass of the day to number four, Ricky Ross. There are now 9 seconds to go in regulation. Looks like we're headed to overtime. Let's go back to Tim and Mike.
Ooh, that's a lot of points in regulation time. 37-37.
That's a key game. That's an undefeated team there for Bobby Simmons at Oklahoma State.
Third down and three. Zeroway. Zeroway dancing back. Saved what would have been a loss. May turn out to be a loss of about a half yard anyway, but he got four back himself. Hairston was there, the tackle, number 93, along with the linebacker Smith and Pearson Prelo.
You know, it's tough to run the football when you've got more people in the box than you can possibly block, and that's what happened on that last play.
Fourth down. Tech, good defense, forcing the punt. Bauman to Harrison. Harrison signals fair catch. And it's down by West Virginia at the 47-yard line. Well, they're going to mark it closer to the 48. Well, follow your favorite team all season long on CBS Sportsline. We've got scores, highlights, breaking news, and all kinds of in-depth info. CBS Sportsline is your online source for stats on all 112 Division I-A teams. Plus, our team of journalists is working hard to cover all your favorite sports. Check it out at cbs.sportsline.com. Just a 24-yard punt for Bauman. And so once again, Tech starting near midfield, this time at the 48. Oxendine plows for maybe four.
Just exactly what we talked about up top. This is going to be a blue-collar kind of day today. Offensive lines, defensive lines. Who wins the battle up front? This West Virginia defense is getting better and better each week.
Three nothing game. Mountaineers leading on the field goal. Second and five. Maybe a long five. Missed timing on that handoff to Oxendine. Still wound up picking up a couple. Gary Tompkins, number 11, came up to make the stop from the secondary. And time about to expire here in the first quarter at Mountaineer Field. With the score, West Virginia 3, Virginia Tech nothing. We'll return to Mountaineer Field after this message and a word from your local station. You're looking at Cooper's Rock in Cooper's Rock State Park, not too far from Morgantown, West Virginia, on this cloudy day here in this beautiful state, as autumn colors are still very much alive. Back here at Mountaineer Field, I'm Tim Ryan with Mike Mayock, and we have a 3-0 game, a 30-minute first quarter here. West Virginia on top. Little goal by Taylor from 44 yards out. Third down, Hokies. Flags everywhere, just as Clark made the handoff. Gary Stills came in to make the play, but there's a flag on the play.
Somebody had to jump because there was still 9 seconds left on the play clock.
Prior to the snap, ball starts. Offense, 5 yards. Replay, third down.
See, that really hurts now.
Clock. Read 15 minutes.
So they reset the clock to read 15 minutes because the play never happened. Gennaro DiNapoli, their best offensive line and most experienced player. Don't see DiNapoli making this kind of mistake. He was so fired up on third and three to get a hit on Clay that he jumped just a bit early.
That'll make it third and eight. The senior from Casanova, New York, not far from Syracuse. Talk about pumped up. He was ready for that game. Look at the difference there. West Virginia with 87 yards to 18 total offense first quarter, despite the Hokies having better field position. Clark gets some time here trying to find an open man. Oxendine helps him out. Great job by Ken Oxendine. Seeing the quarterback in trouble, came back for the ball and wound up with a first down. Damon Cogdell made the tackle.
It's an excellent job by the quarterback, Al Clark, holding on to the football. Here's Oxendine. He's going to work his way back across. And what happens is the quarterback waits till he comes clear because he's not clear early. Wait, step up, and now deliver the football. That's an excellent job by Al Clark, waiting for Oxendine to come over and a key first down.
17-yard gain. Oxendine driven back, but got about three on the initial burst before he's pushed back. Cogdell there again. Hadley, the linebacker, 52, and Barrett Green coming up from the safety position, number 33.
There's one of the problems right now with Virginia Tech's offense is they're losing their big play guy, Sean Scales. Easily their deepest vertical threat. Look at what he's done so far this season. First, fourth, sixth, but the number at the bottom, 121 all-purpose yards they're losing per game. That's a huge loss.
Mountaineers without their top receiver, David Saunders, down for the season with a knee injury. Nice play action fake, but pressure on Clark, and now he takes off. This is when he's dangerous. He's got first down yardage. Damon Cogdell forced him out. Flag on the play, however. Might be a late hit on Cogdell as Clark ran out of bounds.
No, I think you're right, Timmy. I think it is Cogdell. Clark got enough to get the first. Look at Frank Beamer's hat. He's saying, what is going on here? You're saying we're dirty and you're hitting our quarterback out of bounds. He's got the game face going today, and that, but you called that exactly right. That's where Al Clark is dangerous. He gets outside the pocket, he gets on the edge, he gets enough for the first down, and then Damon Cogdell takes the shot at him out of bounds.
Dead ball, personal foul, defense. Half the distance to the goal from the end of the run, first down.
Games like this, Don Nealon knows penalties, turnovers, special teams plays, win and lose these kind of games. You can't afford to give up extra yards. You're going to fight for everything. Look at him. Good feet. Gets outside Stills. Gets outside Slay and Thornton. And there's the late shot. He barely hit him. But they're going to call it anyway.
Well out of bounds. That's the problem.
Exactly.
Cogdell. First down. Ball just inside the 12-yard line of the Mountaineers. Oxendine is stuffed at the line of scrimmage. Cogdell made the stop again. Cogdell's been all over the field here, sometimes out of the field, but he's making plays.
Yeah, if he stays within the 53 yards of width, he's okay, but that one play cost him half the distance, but he's really an active weak side linebacker.
Oxendine gets only about 6 inches gain on the play, so it's virtually a second and 10.
This is the situation you don't want to be in, the long, second long, third long against this defense.
Off from the shotgun, pressure just got it up and nearly picked up. Clark unloaded. He had pressure from Sweeney, the senior linebacker from Greensburg, Pennsylvania, who's out there with a sore knee following arthroscopic surgery about 10 days ago.
Get a good rush on the quarterback here, the push. They've got six guys lined up, and they're coming with six. That's bomb from the top of the screen. Good hit by Sweeney and bomb, but look what's happened. That's who he wanted. He saw Stewie fall, and he can't come to him.
Third and 10. Clark now 3 of 5 passing. We'll watch quarterback draw here. Line down again. Clark to the end zone. Complete touchdown. If it stands, Ken Handy. Junior from Arlington, Virginia, 12-yard touchdown pass, but there is a discussion on the field with a yellow flag down.
That's a touchdown.
Touchdown!
And the touchdown will stand offside against West Virginia. And the Hokies are in front.
And you know, Mark did a great job reading the play again, coming to the receiver with single coverage, Ken Handy on the inside cut, and no free safety in the middle of the field. Excellent job so far by Al Clark making the right decisions on pass game.
Shane Graham with the point after, and a 7-3 Virginia Tech lead.
Ken Handy's playing because of the injury to Sean Scales. Take a look at the eyes of Al Clark. He's looking weak side the whole time. He comes open late, delivers the football on time. Handy beats his man, number 4, Charles Fisher, to the inside. It's a 7-3 ball game.
A 12-yard pass from Clark to Ken Handy has Virginia Tech on top 7-3 early in the second quarter. Let's take a look at it again, Mike.
Yeah, it's a great read, both by Handy here, knowing he has man-to-man working, pushing off to get inside, and knowing that the free safety can't get involved. And what I like about this is the read by the quarterback. Handy pushes off. Now watch the left hand come out, the cut across the middle. That's an excellent read, both by the split end and the quarterback, knowing there was no free safety in the hole.
And as you said, Handy is playing. Deshaun Scales, Harrison and Stewie are the starters, and Handy the third wide receiver. That was the situation on that play, and happy Al Clark and Ken Handy combined. Kibble will kick it off. Keaton and Terry are the deep men. Taken at the 4-yard line by Nate Terry. Works his way up the sideline. Gets out over the 30-yard line before he's driven out of bounds. Well, tonight on CBS, it's America's Night of Television, so tune in for Dr. Quinn, Medicine Woman, followed by Early Edition, and then Walker, Texas Ranger. That's all tonight on CBS. We have a first down right at the 30-yard line for the Mountaineers of West Virginia, here at home at Mountaineer Field. Kim Ryan with Mike Mayock, and Mark Bulger brings him on. Passing at 5 of 7 for 64 yards.
But once again, working with the long field is West Virginia because of the special team field position situation.
Under pressure, escapes that one, and now sideline throws it out of bounds. Prelo had the pressure on him, and Pearson Prelo, interesting to watch because literally all over the field, and that's why he's called a rover, and with Moore coming with him. Bulger, forced from the pocket, just threw that one out of bounds.
Yeah, that's a good job right there. I'd always rather have my quarterback throw in about the 10th row and come back on 2nd and 10 and play football.
And he's 2nd and 10 at the 30. The Mountaineers. Mark Plants in the lineup for fullback Leroy White. Bulger, little screen. Garraway appears to have the first down. It'll be very close. He's forced out by Keon Carpenter. Depending on the spot, looks like he's going to be short of the first down by about a yard. Amos Garraway, 896 yards rushing, showed his pass-catching ability with a little draw, with the little screen pass.
There's a big one in the Big Ten. Michigan handling Michigan State more easily than people anticipated, and Ohio State down 3 early. Arizona. Possible upset, Washington State. And look at that second overtime. It's like our game last week with BC and Miami.
Zeroway has the first down and a little more. They'll spot it just inside the 44-yard line. Steve Tate, the linebacker, joined by Corey Bird, number 16, put the stop on Zeroway. Zeroway, the number 5 rusher in all of the NCAA Division I, averaging 149 yards a game. 10 touchdowns already for famous Amos. Bothered still with a little quad injury suffered a couple of weeks back. Bulger connects for another first down. That's Ivy, Corey Ivy. Corey Ivy, the sophomore from Boca Raton, with another grab.
Don Nealon told us yesterday that Corey Ivey was easily the best, the biggest surprise of this season and a direct result of the David Saunders injury.
Corey Ivey wears a T-shirt underneath his jersey. There it is for his late brother, Reynard Ivey, who was killed last year at the age of 22, riding a bicycle, was hit by a train. They were very close. So that's his tribute. From Chesapeake, Virginia, 46-yard touchdown pass from Mark Bulger. Jay Taylor for the point after. And the Mountaineers are back on top.
And boy, did Foreman accelerate away from Larry Green to get to that football. Showcases the speed of Sean Foreman. They were running stride for stride. Great job by Bulger letting the football go out ahead. And look at the extension. He separates away from Larry Green. That's just a great job by both the quarterback Bulger and receiver Sean Foreman.
Well, CBS Sports coverage of NASDAQ College football will continue after this message and a word from your local station.
For college football action, the address is CBS. Welcome home.
Well, there's Sean Foreman, number 16, and the recipient of that pass from Bulger. You see Bulger on the headset. Sean Foreman back on Saturday, August 16th, was one unhappy young man as we see the play again. It was that day that David Saunders twisted his knee, and that gave Sean Foreman the opportunity to be the man to replace his best buddy among the receiving corps, and he has just been great. He's leading the Big East in pass receptions this season, and he racks up 46 yards and a touchdown there from the sophomore quarterback, Mark Bulger.
Really did a good job separating from Larry Green.
Mike Charlton returning the kickoff for the Hokies. Got near the 20, and then a swarm of Mountaineers buries him. Now for an update, let's go to Jim Nance in New York.
All right, Tim, the first play after a Kentucky missed field goal, the Georgia Bulldogs strike. Robert Edwards, watch the patience here. Waits for the hole to develop. Blockers in front. Then Edwards is off racing 80 yards to the end zone, and Georgia leads 7-0 with 12:27 to go in the second quarter. Tim?
Well, thanks, Jim. Georgia, Kentucky. We'll be keeping up to date on that one all day long, of course. First down here at the 20-yard line for the Hokies of Virginia Tech. And Cullen Hawkins and Lamont Pegisa come into the backfield now. For Virginia Tech, a fumble by Clark and a loose ball. It's picked up by the Mountaineers, and they will have it at the 21-yard line of Virginia Tech.
Frank Beamer can't believe it. The most basic function in a football game, the center quarterback exchange. Al Clark trying to get out and give the football away, loses it, gets caught up in the legs of Todd Washington, and it comes up with Cogdell again. Damon Cogdell has been incredibly active already in this first half.
So the Mountaineers will have the ball with a first down at the 21 of the Hokies.
Hi, Jim Nance in New York coming up at halftime from our College Football Today studios. Craig and Lou will join me with scores and highlights. Is there a better unit right now in college football than the Michigan defense? It picked off the Michigan State quarterback six times today to stay unbeaten. Now back to the game.
Well, what happens here on this play? Watch what happens with Todd Washington trying to reach it. John Thornton, the nose guard. He pulls out quick, trying to get there. And the ball gets dropped on the ground. Cogdell comes up with it. Tim, we talked in the open about turnovers in tight ball games, and here's one right in the red zone.
That was the first one, and what a key one it is. First down at the 21-yard line. Mark Bulger is 8 for 11, 130 yards and a touchdown. Sean Foreman has control of the offense again.
Martin motion to fullback. It's a Statue of Liberty to Zerway. Zerway breaks a tackle. Downed at the 1 yard line. Anthony Midget tripped him up at the one after a 20 yard gain. And the Statue of Liberty plays. Arroway told us he was hoping they'd go to that.
They did this twice against Miami a couple of weeks ago. Both times worked for big yardage. It looks like pass. Here's Arroway. He's going to roll around and follow the block in here. That's just a great job. The key block out in front. Tate can't catch him. And now when you get Amos in the open field, he almost slips right there. That's twice today. And then just a good open field tackle prevents a touchdown.
Goal line.
Good effort there. Midget and Carpenter came up to prevent him from getting into the end zone.
There's Dan Simrell, the offensive coordinator. We had a lot of fun with him yesterday. We asked him if he was going to be upstairs in the booth or downstairs on the field. He said, hey, guys, they shoot guns too well around here. They don't like my play calling. That Mountaineer is way too accurate.
Bulger on the sneak. Takes it in after the touchdown set up by Zerway on the Statue of Liberty, a 20-yard gain. The first turnover has produced a score for the Mountaineers. And the point after is good.
And remember, it's the football that has to cross the plane of the end zone, not the player. Let's see where that football is. Looks like it just gets across. Good call. 17-7 ball game, West Virginia.
Assessor.
Well, it is now 17-7 for the hometown Mountaineers here in Morgantown, leading the Hokies. And we want to remind you that we've got a chance to check out the results of last week's CBS Sports Lion All-Time Greats Bowl. You picked the greatest offensive lineman of all time, and it was Orlando Pace of Ohio State, beating out Hannah, Remington, Mandarich, and Bill Fralick.
Some pretty good names there.
You bet. Well, jump on to cbs.sportsline.com this week and make your choice for the greatest college football defensive lineman of all time. Here are the nominees: Leroy Selman of Oklahoma, Bubba Smith of Michigan State, Ross Browner of Notre Dame, Hugh Green of Pittsburgh, and Randy White of Maryland. Tune into our game next weekend. Find out who is the fans' choice in the CBS Sportsline All-Time Greats Poll.
I don't know. I'm thinking Bubba.
You're thinking better.
I can always remember that 10-10 game, the tie ball game, and then when he racked up his leg against the sideline marker.
Deep kick up into the end zone. Will not be brought out by Ike Charlton. So the Hokies will start first down from their 20 down by 10. Let's go to our reporter, Dave Logan.
All right. Thank you very much, Tim. I am with the proud and exciting father of quarterback Mark Bulger. Jim, I don't know who's more excited in this game, you or your son.
Oh, I don't know. My heart's pounding pretty much. I'm very excited. Mark's probably cold as a cucumber.
Now, you're an old quarterback from Notre Dame. You graduated in 73. What do you tell him about big games like this? What do you and your son talk about?
Really not too much, Dave. Mark has it all under control. I get nervous, and he just stays calm.
All right, well, we'll let you go ahead and enjoy the game. Okay, thanks for being with us. Tim.
There's Mark Bulger, the 6'3", 190-pound sophomore, is only going to get bigger. And he's certainly shown already the poise of a veteran quarterback at the college level, just the sophomore in his first year as a starter. On first down, and the whistle blew before the flag was thrown, we believe, but a flag is down. Wait and see here as Al Clark trying to get something going for the Hokies.
You know, Virginia Tech is just out of sync so far.
Right to the snap. Delay a game. Offense.
Wow, that's it. They ran out of time on the clock.
Please reset the clock.
And on a change of
23.
On a change of possession, that's inexcusable. You're coming in from the sideline on a first and 10 after a change of possession. You can't run the clock down and get called in that. Center quarterback exchange, turnover, penalties. You can't win these kind of games.
Hokies 4-0 in the Big East. West Virginia 2-1. First down. Oxendine gets about a yard. Let's go to Jim Nance in New York for an update.
Tim, Oklahoma State undefeated on the season. End of second overtime, going for two, going for the win. Tony Lindsay out of the spread, stopped short of the goal line, and Missouri has upset Oklahoma State, handing them their first loss. Let's go back now to Tim and Mike.
How about that? What a finish. Missouri, Oklahoma State. 51-50.
How'd you like that formation? They had half of them set up on the hash and half set up in the middle of the field.
Basketball, the score decides it. Second down, 15. Hart with a quarterback draw. Takes a hard hit at the 25-yard line from Nate Terry, number 28.
The ball carrier. Stop name number 28, Nate Terry.
About an 11-yard pickup for Clark.
Third and four.
It'll leave third down and four.
Now this means, I love this graphic here, Virginia Tech only five turnovers coming in. They have six now. West Virginia, number three in the country with seven. These are two teams used to protecting the football, and that's why we highlighted it at the top of the show.
One turnover so far, and it has been costly. To Virginia Tech on third down. Clark in and out of the hands of Handy, number 48, the third wide receiver. And Clark took quite a shot.
Stills again.
Just after he released the ball.
And Brad Baylor is a little bit injured, but I'll tell you what, Baylor's fighting a losing battle against Gary Stills. He just continues to put heat on Al Clark.
Tech now 1 of 5 on third down conversions, has not been able to move the ball. There's a fake on the punt, and Bauman has more than a first down. He's all the way out to the 45-yard line. Kibble, Jimmy Kibble, the punter for Virginia Tech.
Oh.
A perfectly executed fake.
I'll tell you, when you least expect it, Frank Beamer, who's the head coach and special teams coach of this Virginia Tech team, has always been on the cutting edge of special teams. And in this case, in their own backyard, the direct snap right here, and they're going to run option. Watch what happens. Direct snap to the fullback. The dish by number 14, that's Nick Sorensen, the backup quarterback, dishes it to the punter, Kibble. Man, that's a huge play because you need momentum. They were dying. They're losing by 10. Great play.
29-yard run out to the 46-yard line of West Virginia. And again, a whistle before they were able to snap the ball.
Man, I love that call. That shows so much guts and some confidence in your defense to do that back in your own half of the field. Momentum going against you in a hostile field, that's just wonderful.
How about Jimmy Kibble? What a thrill for him to make that big play. Punters don't get to do that too often. Play action, Clark has some time, going deep. Broken up by Nate Terry, intended for Harrison. Terry the junior from Homestead, Florida. Had strong coverage on Angelo Harrison.
Junior college transfer with good coverage. Now you got to turn and look. When he turns and look there, you get your left hand out there. Now try and elevate the football. That is really good defensive back play. Excellent hustle by Harrison also, but just a great job by the corner. Nate Terry, junior college transfer with excellent coverage.
Second and 10, Hokies at the 45-yard line of West Virginia, down by 10 points. 8:21 to go in the half. Cogdell and Barrett Green are there to stop Oxendine. Oxendine given about a yard on the carry.
Really impressed so far with the front seven, or call it front eight, of West Virginia. They're putting 7 and 8 consistently in the box and daring Virginia Tech to beat them by throwing the football.
Tech averages 4.6 yards a carry this season. Today, they've got 17 yards on 12 carries. From the shotgun, has time, and it is almost picked up by Perlo Bastine, number 3, the sophomore from Delray Beach, Florida, intended for Handy.
Now, Bastien is the only returning starter in this secondary, the wide side corner. I thought he jumped it a little bit early. Let's see the look. He's got good coverage on Handy. No, that's just an excellent play. Should have had the interception. Watch 55 right down here. That's Stills. The ball's been delivered 1-2. He took three steps and pushed him, folks. As far as I'm concerned, that's unnecessary roughness. That should have been a flag.
Hunting situation again for the Hokies. And a short one off the side of his foot. Bounces at the 30, is down at the 32-yard line. And Kibble cannot believe what happened there.
And how quickly we fall, huh, Timmy?
12 yards on the punt. Here's a young man who ran for 29 to get them down into Mountaineer territory.
Off the side of his left foot, he knows it right away. He can't believe he just did that. And now you got to get down there and cover it, Jim.
He averages nearly 45 yards a punt. First in the Big East, and that one, he just blew it.
Yeah, he wanted that in the corner, and occasionally when you try and get too fine from coffin corner kick, it will slide off the side.
First down, Mountaineers from their own 31-yard line. Zeroway, nowhere. Good defensive play by Steve Tate, the walk-on linebacker, number 49. Came in as a walk-on from North Canton, Ohio. Leads the team in tackles with 53, 32 of them solo, and 15 against Boston College.
Yeah, I love this. Engelberger, Hairston, Tate, and Wheel. Four defenders, all start. Former walk-on, along with Stewie, the wide receiver. And Engelberger and Tate were just in a Sports Illustrated article by Ivan Mazel, talking about the top walk-ons in the country.
Anthony Green in at fullback. With Sarah Lane, he's got running room. Five Hokies needed to bring him down near the 25-yard line. Anthony Midget got dragged along with Lauren Johnson by Famous Amos, 44 yards.
And the key block was the backside guard, Randy Dunnigan. You're going to see him pull out right here and make the play. Watch what happens with Dunnigan. Here comes the pull on the counter tray. He makes one block. You get two guys out in front of him, and now it's all Amos in the open field. Wow, look at the, he picks up an extra 15 yards just by running top and making one hard move.
Zeroway acknowledges he looks at the stats of the other named backs in the country. He thinks he should be right there with him. He's ranked number five coming into today. Vulture, complete to Foreman. Foreman breaks a tackle, gets inside the five-yard line.
There's that bootleg we talked about earlier, and if he had time, he could have thrown a touchdown pass over the top. He had so many people open. Another great catch by Sean Foreman. Here's a look. Now, look, he's got people. Corey Ivey open deep. Foreman elevates, catches the football. Great job, and almost an offensive face mask.
Foreman came in as a linebacker, became a defensive back, wanted to be a receiver, and has his shot. Leading the Big East in that category this year. Zeroway battles to the 3-yard line. Anthony Midget, along with Corey Bird, combined to pull him down. Midget, the sophomore cornerback from Clewiston, Florida, has seen more of Zeroway than he would like to today.
Yeah, Midget's limping a little bit after that play. Had some help from Corey Bird, and I don't know about you, Tim, but I'm having trouble looking at number 16 playing defense for the Hokies after watching Jim Druckenmiller at quarterback the last 2 years.
Good point. Zeroway now has 83 yards rushing, and he has a touchdown to go with it. Amos Zeroway, a 3-yard touchdown run, and the Mountaineers beating up on the Hokies.
Canis with the key block on Bird. Good job by Zeroway reading the block, cutting up inside. That's like stealing.
Well, that 12-yard punt set them up for the scoring opportunity. Bulger to Foreman, hard running by Zeroway, and a 3-yard score makes it 24-7.
24-7 West Virginia on this play. Pukenas comes out here and gets the key block, and then the fullback inside, and the rest is all famous Amos. Pukenas comes out, gets Corey Burt, number 16. Then the fullback, that's Anthony Green, gets a key block inside. And, folks, you got no shot of stopping Amos Arroway when he gets two good blocks at the point of attack.
West Virginia, 2-1 in the Big East. 4-0 in the Big East. West Virginia has Syracuse, Temple, and Pittsburgh remaining in conference play. Tech has Miami and Pittsburgh. And suddenly, West Virginia with a 24-7 lead, asserting themselves here in the race for the Big East Championship.
And you know the folks in Syracuse, New York, who are idle this week, are sitting home watching this ball game and saying, we are right back in it, because we host West Virginia, and if they can stay on top today, next week, it's a huge ball game.
Taylor's kickoff, taken at the 2-yard line by Ike Charlton. Reverse taken by Prelo, but he is dropped back at the 5.
KC Schiller did a great job.
Reserve linebacker Schiller made the tackle. And a reminder that next Saturday we've got more college football for you here on CBS. The NASDAQ College Football will feature number 6 Florida at home against number 16 Georgia. Hot-handed Mike Bobo leads the Bulldogs against Jacquez Green and Steve Spurrier's Florida Gators.
Now, Frank Beamer has always been a special teams guy, and he will try and change the complexion of a ball game. He's already faked the punt, which was a big play, but then the reverse on the kickoff worked against him.
Mountaineer fans alive. McGee's in front of the running backs. This is McGee's. Off McGee's, a transfer from Clemson. 217 yards rushing coming into the game. He backs up Oxendine, gives him a little different look. Here's what happened. Jay Taylor opened the scoring with a 44-yard field goal for West Virginia in a very speedily played first quarter. Gave them the early lead. Tech came back on a pass from Clark to Ken Handy from 12 yards out. And then Sean Foreman, a 46-yard touchdown reception from Mark Bulger. Bulger ran it in from 1 yard out. And then Amos Arroway, after setting up this score with a 42-yard run, scored it from 3 yards away. And Thornton stuffs the run at the 10-yard line.
And Henry Slay and John Thornton are controlling the line of scrimmage. Tech's going to have to throw the football. To watch these two guys close right in here. This is just great football domination at the line of scrimmage. Thornton and Clay, bang, meet in the backfield.
Lamont Pegues stopped twice after being a total of just 3 yards, so it is third down and a long 6.
Tech's going to have to throw the ball and run down to win this football game.
3 receivers to the right. Clark rolls that way. Clark is escaping the sack, but no, he doesn't get out of there. From behind, John Hadley. John Hadley, the linebacker from Delray Beach, the senior, caught him from behind.
Steve Dunlap, the defensive coordinator, told us they were going to have a rat this week. The rat would be spying the quarterback. Hadley sits, waits, stays, and now he reacts up and makes the great play, shoestring tackle from behind.
And they just get it away. Kibble's punt out to the 50-yard line. Good punt by him. Nate Terry will return it. Hit hard at the 45-yard line, but holds on to that football. And again, the Mountaineers inside Tech territory. A 42-yard punt, a 7-yard return, and Ryan Smith made the tackle. And there's Hadley, the man who caught Al Clark from behind, forcing that punt situation. And Virginia Tech with another good opportunity. Today's NASDAQ Scholar Athlete of the Game is Henry Slay of West Virginia. NASDAQ's commitment to the investment in our future is shown today by donating $1,000 to West Virginia's General Scholarship Foundation. On first down, the Mountaineers. Zeroing dances over the 40-yard line to the 38.
And West Virginia's got it going. Look at Henry Slay.
Hey, Larry, baby. All right, doing it. Come on.
That's Bill Kurlevich saying, hey, come on, let's get back in here. Kurlevich has been here a long time. Defensive line coach for West Virginia's 19th season.
Second down situation, long five for West Virginia.
The ball at the 39.
Bulger, play action, going deep. Corey Ivey just overthrows him, number eight. Intended receiver, Corey Ivey. Bulger has been very sharp, as he was in practice on Thursday when we got a chance to watch this youngster. Very poised for a sophomore. Still growing into his own body. He's tall at 6'3". They list him at 190. I would guess more at about 180. But he's going to grow into that frame.
Yeah, especially when you see his dad standing there at 6'5", and apparently played at about 230. He's only a sophomore. I love his quick release. Doesn't come over the top, but he's got a real quick release.
West Virginia with their second unit offensive line in, giving the first team rest. The 23-yard line. He had all kinds of running room out the right side. Prelo forced him out. 17 more yards.
Now, when you allow the backside to do what happened on that, and that was to close down the whole backside of the Virginia Tech defensive line, watch what happens here. You're going to get this. He misses the tackle, and then we get a block in here by the wide receiver, Pat Green, and that's the key. Look what happens. He walls him off, and as soon as you wall him off, Amos Zaraway is going to steal him from Baby there. That's not a problem.
But it's just too long.
The second time they've run that pattern today where Ivy's had an opportunity to make a play. The end of the play, Ivy's working on the wheel route. Little bump and grind there with Prelo. Look at the extension. Almost gets there, and I think that's a good no call by the ref.
That'll leave second and 10 from the 23-yard line. Behind the ball is Pat Green. And he gives to Zaraway, a nice tackle that time. Jamel Smith, the linebacker, number 46, smelled that out, found room to slice in and trip him up.
Yeah, they tried to run that counter trade, backside guard and tackle, and Jamel Smith did a great job coming in behind them.
He had 106 yards before that play, losing a yard.
There's the key, though. They've never lost a football game in the 2 years that Amos Zaraway's been here when he goes over 100. Here we are, Tim, in the second quarter. He's already got it.
Third and 11. Two wide receivers to the left. Bulger screen, Zaraway. Zaraway's got a blocker, jumps over a pair of legs and dives to the 10-yard line. What a show by this guy. Pearson Prelo made the tackle on him there, but the Mountaineers threaten again with a first down on a 14-yard pickup by Zaraway.
When you give him a sliver of daylight and a couple of big fellas out in front of him, this guy's dangerous. Watch Brock Holland, number 69, out in front. The good block by Pat Green, and here comes Holland. He's going to bury the defensive back, and Zaraway does the rest.
1:12 to go in the half, 24-7, the lead for the Mountaineers. Over the Hokies. Zaraway this time met at the line of scrimmage. Nowhere to go. The linebacker, Tate, met him in the hole.
You know what? Timeout by West Virginia. They've got it exactly where they want. 24-7 with a minute and two left.
1:02 remains. Mountaineers on top. Sellout crowd of 63,500 and then some enjoying this one as their Mountaineers are on top 24-7, a minute left in the half. Tech has won 6 of the last 8 meetings between these teams. 2 years ago here, they shut out the Mountaineers 27-0, then beat them at Blacksburg last year 31-14. Ivy with a diving grab at the 1-yard line, Corey Ivy. What a day he's having.
Good read there, both by Ivy and the quarterback, because the defensive back laid off. The ball's on the 10-yard line. You can't give them that big a cushion, and that was just a good 3-step drop, and they hit the slant.
Ivy with his third catch, a total of 39 yards here in the first half. 49 seconds remain. The Mountaineers on the doorstep, a yard away. Don Nealon's West Virginia Mountaineers up 24-7. 49 seconds remain. Virginia Tech with three timeouts remaining. The Mountaineers have one left, and they are at the one-yard line. Coming up at halftime, on the College Football Today halftime report, Jim Nance, Craig James, and Lou Holtz will get you caught up on all of the scores and highlights. So stay with us. We'll be there shortly for our studios in New York.
Huge play here.
Sarah with the tailback. The blocker and a good diving defensive play. That is Carpenter coming up from the safety spot. Keon Carpenter, he has had a solid first half for the Hokies, and he comes up big there. Loss of 2 yards on the play.
Keon Carpenter right here slices through and comes underneath and makes a key tackle, will force him to go for the field goal. That's just a great job by the free safety. Penetrating defense.
Junior from Baltimore, Maryland.
Attempting a field goal.
Taylor will attempt a field goal try from the 10-yard line. Nails the 20-yarder for another 3 points for the Mountaineers. 10 seconds still remain. 27-7. The Mountaineers of West Virginia leading the Hokies of Virginia Tech.
Watch the right guard stick his foot out on this field goal here, and then watch the reaction by Beamer.
And the kickoff brought out to the 31-yard line.
Here it is again. The right guard knows he's got to get to his right side. Right there. Steps the leg out on John Engelberger. And then on the sideline, Frank Beamer watches the whole thing. Says, wait a minute. He's got the leg out. What are you doing?
He didn't get the call.
Come on, we're going to block that thing if he doesn't do that.
I think he had a better view of it than the officials did. Kendrick, meanwhile, brought that kickoff out to the 30-yard line with 2 seconds left on the clock. Now Clark gets the play organized. 2 seconds remain first half. West Virginia in total command here in this first half, 27-7. And we're in a timeout here as the Hokies will have one opportunity to try and make something miraculous happen here to end the half.
That guy with the headset on back there, what a good football coach he is. Steve Dunlap, defensive coordinator for West Virginia. I tease him all the time. He still holds, Tim, the all-time record for tackles in a game back in the mid-70s when he had 28 tackles against Boston College.
And being your a BC, old school.
Well, I always tell him, yeah, you got 28 tackles, but they were all 10 yards downfield.
He may also hold the record for viewing football videotape, and I think you're probably number two.
I think he and I could have sat there for a couple hours the other night. He was showing me all his zone blitzes. He's very proud of what he's doing, and justifiably.
Great guy. All right, first down, one play remaining, first half. They put 2 seconds back on, 4 seconds for Clark from the shotgun. Steps up in the pocket and heaves it. He has got a gun. And it is intercepted at the 23-yard line by Nate Terry as the gun sounds to end the first half. It's been all here at home before a sellout crowd. The Mountaineer faithful pouring into this stadium since early this morning have enjoyed this first half effort. They remember all too well that 2 years ago they were shut out by the Hokies, 27-0. Let's go down to Dave Logan.
All right, Coach Nealon, too much zero way, and your big quarterback played outstanding in the first half.
Well, we played pretty good this first half, but I've been around this game long enough to know that this doesn't mean a whole heck of a lot, and they've kind of whipped us a lots of times, so we're kind of figuring it's nothing.
At the same time, Coach, your defense, outstanding job on Oxendine.
They've played pretty hard, and they're playing hard. It's a good football game.
All right, Coach, we'll see you in the second half. Tim.
Okay, David Logan, that's the end of the first half with the score. The Mountaineers 27, the Hokies 7. Jim Nance, Craig James, and Lou Holtz will be along with a Ford College Football Halftime Report right after this word from your local station.
The College Football Today Ford Division Halftime Report is sponsored by Ford Division.
And back at our College Football Today studios, Jim Nance with the Ford Halftime Report, and Craig and Lou alongside. Lou, you coaches always talk about turnovers being so key. That was the story today, Michigan and Michigan State. The Wolverines did not turn it over once, yet forced six interceptions. How about this? Michigan defense has not given up a point this year in the fourth quarter, playing like Paul Bunyan out there on defense. Early, though, Craig, it looked like it might be Michigan State's day.
And a lot of trickery here. The fake field goal to Cedric Irvin for the touchdown, but then Michigan comes back. They get Greasy in with a quarterback sneak. The offensive line for Michigan showed up and performed.
Todd Schultz threw five of the interceptions. Charles Woodson grabbed two of them. Just a nightmare day. No answers for Schultz. And Michigan got 107 yards on the ground by Chris Howard. Only 9 points allowed in the second half in seven games this year for the undefeated Wolverines. Missouri for the second straight year beats Oklahoma State in overtime. Double overtime. They'll be second-guessing Bob Simmons down there for a long time. Here's what happened. 30 unanswered points to come back from 23 down near the end of regulation. 2 minutes to go. That put them up 37-30, Oklahoma State. Missouri charges back. Here's the touchdown pass that would send it to overtime. Corby Jones threw four touchdown passes. Now in the OT, Jones running the option will keep it and score. They'll kick the extra point. Now Oklahoma State must match it. Down 51-44. Lindsey will reach for the pylon. And they give him the touchdown. Now they decide to go for two after a timeout.
Well, this is a play they had planned on. But what happened was when they came out in this formation, Missouri called timeout, made the adjustment. That would have been fine, except that when Missouri called timeout, you lost the element of surprise.
Worst decision, Craig, you think?
Absolutely. You know, this is one of those deals where you have to make good decisions. And I'd gone back to the regular offense, and I'd have done something where I'd have given my team a chance to get in there. The element of surprise you're talking about, it was gone, eliminated. Get away from yard bird football, play football, and give yourself a chance.
Yeah, they showed him the spread look before the timeout, and it spoils what was an undefeated season for Oklahoma State going into that game. Indiana has not scored a touchdown in 18 quarters. Has been blown out in its last four games, 168-6. Toledo scored the last 21 against Bowling Green to remain unbeaten, 7-0 on the year. Alabama had lost three straight conference games, and then today stormed back against the Ole Miss Rebels. They finally picked up a ground game, too, for quarterback Freddie Kitchens, who was airing it out also.
Ed Schism on the swing pass there. Gets them within it, 23-14. Ole Miss is down, and Alabama running back Dennis Riddle breaks through the middle, zigzags, goes 68 yards for the touchdown. The fiddle Riddle had a good day, but so did Curtis Alexander. And the running back showed up for Alabama. They'd only had one guy go over 100 yards all season. That was against Kentucky in a losing effort.
And Alexander today had 141. This is one of the most exciting players in college football. John Avery, right after the Riddle touchdown, takes the kick back 100 yards and makes a beautiful cut at the 20. Now, Ole Miss decided to go for two. That would have brought them in within 29-22, but failed, and Bama wins it at Ole Miss. Temple and Miami and the Hurricanes, 600 yards total offense, 313 on the ground, and the Canes won 58 in a row when rushing for at least 150 yards. This is Edgerrin James, who last week set the conference rushing mark in one game over 260 yards, but James Jackson was the real star. Here's Jackson, 190 yards and two touchdowns, including this romp from 74 yards out.
Miami has struggled this year. They got so many unknown, great potential athletes. I mean, that's what Butch Davis keeps preaching is just, we got young guys, be patient.
Pittsburgh in double overtime keeps Rutgers winless on the year. Pete Gonzalez had seven touchdown passes, including three in a 2.5 minute span of the second quarter. He shatters Dan Marino's school records. And Wisconsin edges Minnesota. The Golden Gophers lose by a point for the second straight week.
Mike Samuel, he comes out and he was on fire today, but he's got a great running game that gives him a chance for the play action. Samuel connects to Donald Hayes. 53-yard touchdown pass. Wisconsin takes a 13-8 lead. And then Minnesota would come back, though. They had a chance here. 21-13 as Byron Evans goes in from the 4-yard line. But it was Great Dane. Great Dane last year at over 200 yards. This time takes it in from 1 yard out. The 22-21 victory and the Paul Bunyan axe, my friend.
Well, they were not tearing down the goalposts. They were chopping it down, Lou.
Well, they were. Last year, Wisconsin was 0-3 in games decided by 4 points or less. This year, they're 4-0. And that's the reason they're sitting there going to a bowl this year.
And Dane, 183 yards rushing, joins Herschel Walker and Marshall Faulk, the only three players for 3,000 yards their first two seasons. We'll be right back. All All right, for you folks enjoying the West Virginia-Virginia Tech game, welcome back to our Ford Halftime Report from our College Football Today studios. And with Zaraway over 100 yards, West Virginia leads by 20. And, Lou, we've talked about it. Zaraway, when he gets 100 yards, West Virginia doesn't lose. 10-0.
No, they're 10-0 now if the form holds true. They'll go 11-0. But West Virginia's offensive line done a tremendous job. In the last three losses, they haven't been able to block Virginia Tech. They are today.
Yeah, the one thing that strikes my mind right in watching this game, Virginia Tech entered, they only had 5 turnovers on the season. They have 2 in this ball game. West Virginia hasn't turned it over, so the opportunistic Virginia Tech ball club needs to hold on to it and try to get something in terms of a big play.
Some today on CBS are enjoying SEC action between the hedges, and Georgia got a touchdown just before the half. Shaky call by Hal Mumme. He admitted it. And Georgia has the lead, and the Dogs were being chased, but the Bulldogs staying stationary and poised, and you'll see why. First, it's Robert Edwards breaking 180 yards to give Georgia the lead.
I'm very confident if this guy had stayed healthy the last 2 years that Georgia would have won a lot more football games, because with him in there, Bobo's a lot better.
Tim Couch will keep for the score to knot it at 7, but you know, Hal Mumme's a gambler, Lou, and he, late in the half, made this play call. It cost him 7.
Well, it cost him 7. Defensively, Kentucky's played very, very well, but the big play by Georgia gave him the lead.
Georgia trying to go to 6-1 and would qualify for a bowl game with a win today. Northwestern and Ohio State, the last 2 Big Ten teams in the Rose Bowl. Miller with a touchdown catch. Pepe Pearson, 7-yard touchdown run, has just capped a 92-yard drive. Bucks lead by 8 at halftime. Arizona with the lead on number 10 Washington State. Ortiz Jenkins with 2 touchdown passes and a run. Just a minute to go, first half. Cal and UCLA and the Bruins are just red hot after 2 opening losses. Cal only suffered 3 or 4 injuries in the pregame warm-ups, beating up on one another, getting pumped up. Didn't do them much good, though, because watch this. The block, Duval Hicks, return for the touchdown, and a little trickery that paid off also for Coach Bob Toledo.
Now, you got to make sure you got your chin strap buckled here. This time they snap it to the flanker. Jim McElroy goes around the corner. UCLA opens up the 21-3 lead. And you talk about how hot they are. During their win streak, they've averaged 49 points per game. That's why they're moving up the charts in the polls.
Could be in that direction today for 40 or more, well up on the Golden Bears. Kansas State and Oklahoma. Michael Bishop, the quarterback, with his 7th touchdown of the season, just a 1-yard keep. Fourth quarter, Oklahoma's 3-0 at home this year, but trailing by 13, almost a full quarter to go. A&M and the Red Raiders, 3.5 remaining, and the Aggies have just tied it on a Brandon Stewart touchdown pass. Purdue is for real. 6 straight wins. Boilermakers 6-1, blowing out winless Illinois today. Billy Dicken, the quarterback.
Well, here he hits a pass on a slant pass to Brian Alford. But the amazing thing is Dickens played very little until this year, and he's done a fantastic job.
And Joe Tiller's 4-0 in Big Ten play. All 3 other new Big Ten coaches now go to 0-13.
And Illinois, 0-7, takes on 1-7 Indiana next week. Lou, we're going to send you out to go give us a report on that game, huh?
I'd buy a ticket to see that sucker.
Mississippi State and Central Florida, 5:46 to go. Central Florida's Dante Culpepper over 300 yards passing. And just a moment ago, the Bulldogs tied it as James Johnson found the end zone, 28-all at Scott Field in Starkville. Boston College and Notre Dame, a battle of 2-5 squads. And Ron Paulus had his best first half, 172 yards, leading the Irish to 300 yards total offense and leading over the Eagles 28-10. Colorado has defeated Texas the last 5 times, and John Hessler with a touchdown pass and a touchdown run as the Buffs lead the Horns by 7 at the intermission. Coming up the second half, Virginia Tech and West Virginia. We'll continue here on CBS in just a moment.
The College Football Today Ford Division Halftime Report has been sponsored by Ford Division.
At Mountaineer Field in Morgantown, West Virginia, I'm Tim Ryan with Mike Mayock. Our score at halftime, the Mountaineers 27, the Virginia Tech Hokies 7. We'll be back with the second half in a moment. Back in Morgantown, a beautiful fall day under cloudy skies. The hometown West Virginia Mountaineers leading 27-7 over arch rival Virginia Tech. And let's go to David Logan with Coach Frank Beamer.
All right, Coach, first of all, concerning the first half, just not what we're used to seeing from Virginia Tech on both sides of the ball.
Well, I thought West Virginia played great. I thought their quarterback hit every pass and had some great calls. And we had a couple of bad calls going against what they were doing. I mean, it was just a great half for them. But if we can come back here and have a second half the way we plan it, we can get back in this ball game.
All right, thanks, Coach. Have a good second half.
Well, thanks, David. Well, Mike, what's he planning?
Well, the first thing they have to do, they have to stop West Virginia. That means Daniel Zaraway, and that means Mark Bolger, the quarterback, who, you heard Frank say, did a great job. And then they've got to control the football and not panic.
Well, Zaraway had 102 yards and 19 carries. He was a busy running back, and he delivered for West Virginia. Mike Charlton, stopped by Jerry Porter, got the ball out to the 29-yard line. You see 286 yards of total offense to 100 for Virginia Tech.
And it's total domination everywhere. Look at that. First downs, rushing yards, passing yards, even turnovers. It's been all West Virginia.
The fumble was a critical one early in the ball game. It came in the second quarter and led to a 17-7 lead on a touchdown dive by Bulger. This is Oxendine on first down for Tech.
Yeah, I don't think Frank Beamer will let his squad panic right now. Frank Beamer is a very calm guy. I think he just got in there and said, that's not Virginia Tech football. That's not Hokie football. Take our time, get out over the ball, our no-huddle offense, and let's control the line of scrimmage.
No-huddle is the way they go. They've got a second and seven. Now, Hawk says he likes this style of play without the huddle. And this time, Marcus Parker met right at the line of scrimmage. Very little gain, if any. Stacked up by the middle of that defensive unit, and John Hadley, the linebacker, making first contact, number 52.
So far, Oxendine, not as effective as Amos Zaraway. Take a look at that, only 20 yards against 102. And Tim, you and I talked in the first half. West Virginia's 10-0 over a two-year period when Amos gains 100 yards.
Third down and six. They've only converted one of seven tries in this situation. Nice play action fake, and it's out for a first down complete to Sullivan, the tight end, number 88. The senior from Boca Raton, Florida, his first catch of the day, has a first down for Virginia Tech.
And that's exactly what they need to do. For Virginia Tech to win the game, we've been talking about Oxendine, but that's the guy right there. Al Clark has got to stay poised. He's got to do a great job reading the defense, and more effectively, he's got to move the football through the air and take the pressure off this run attack.
Shotgun on first down. Clark drills one right to the numbers of Angelo Harrison, number 83.
Oh, boy.
And Harrison, it's like he twisted his foot as he was tackled. Harrison, the junior, 14 catches coming into the game, and he is slow to get up. Now, they are hurting in this position. He backs up Sean Scales, who's out with an ankle tendon injury suffered in the Miami game. And with Harrison, looks like he's up and at least able to limp off, and hopefully he'll be back for Virginia Tech. That leaves Ken Handy and Michael Stewie with Gildersleeve, their receivers.
There's that right ankle. It's going to bend underneath the entire body. Look at that. He's got the weight of two people on him right there. That's a great look at it. You can see why he limped off the field.
Perlo Bastien made the tackle, number three. Handy comes in. Number 48 in for the injured Harrison. First down play, Oxendine broke one tackle and struggled to get maybe a yard before Cogdell, who's had a strong game for the Mountaineers, wraps him up.
You know,
Cogdell, number one.
Up front, these West Virginia front four are once again still dominating the game. John Thornton, the nose guard, getting the better of Todd Washington.
Second and nine. Al Clark, 6 of 12 for 61 yards, been overshadowed by Mark Bulger's performance. Harrison has returned to the game. Angelo Harrison back in. Number 83 for the Hokies. Second and nine. Clark flares it out. Oxendine out of the backfield. Nice move. Eludes one tackler, gets to the 40-yard line. Cogdell there to stop him. It'll leave third down and about three.
Al Clark is taking a beating almost every time he drops back to throw the football. This time it's the middle linebacker, 52. John Hadley comes loose late, right up the middle, takes the shot just as the ball is delivered. Folks, that's a clean shot. There's nothing wrong with that. He's going to flash inside. Number 64, DiNapoli, turns outside, and Hadley comes in untouched.
Third down.
and three, and all kinds of action moving there.
They got him. Good job by Todd Washington snapping the ball. As soon as he sees to his right, people jump off sides, he will snap the ball.
Cogdell and Baum both
defense. The penalty where we're out, first down.
Cogdell wanted a blitz, and Baum was going right with him.
And Washington, watch Washington here, take a look up here, and he reads the motion. As soon as he sees the motion at the top of the screen there, he snaps it, take a knee, 5 yards, that's a big first down.
At the 35-yard line, Tech in their opening offensive series of the second half, down 27-7.
Slay puts the stop on Oxendine that time. Henry Slay, a senior from Elyria, Ohio.
See, I really think Tech's going to have to start throwing the football on first and 10. They've got to go play action and put the ball a little bit more in the hands of Al Clark. Let him get out on the edge with a pass run option. Because West Virginia just geared up for the run game on first down.
He's got second and about nine. Gets some time, but he overthrows the intended receiver, Harrison, who was not able to run full speed.
Harrison limping down there on that pattern. He came in after only one play off following that twisted ankle. I'm not sure he could have cut off with the ball anyway, but he clearly was unable to go all out.
Yeah, if he can't go all out, you've got to get Ken Handy in the game there.
It'll be third and nine. Clark now 7 of 14.
Third down conversions. That's another area they've really fallen down today. They've been a lot. They've been a 45% conversion team on the season. Today, much worse than that.
Harrison still in the game. Bastien has him covered over there on the right side. Almost out of time. They just got it off. Oxendine running hard. Oxendine gets inside the 30, met there by Tompkins and Barrett Green. And Oxendine, a gain of six, maybe seven on the play. That'll leave third down and a long two.
Actually, I think we're in a fourth down situation.
Pardon me, fourth. Fourth down.
A big decision for Frank Beamer. Fourth and a very long two.
Now they've made it.
Yeah, down 20. No huddle offense. And the fans are into it, Tim.
They have made the decision.
Three wideouts in the game.
Clark, and a little behind the intended receiver, Harrison.
Bad pass, and Clark knows it. He's blaming himself right there. Harrison was wide open. All he had to do was lead him, and they had a first down. And that's a key play there. They needed points. Let's see what happens here. Clark delivers the football. The ball's way behind him. Tough play for Tech.
Al Clark, Virginia Tech quarterback, on the headset there, and Mike, tough play for him to miss on this one.
Yeah, look at the reaction here. Stills working to get at him. Look, he knows he threw it way behind to a wide receiver, Harrison, who was wide open in a critical fourth and three situation. And when he came over to the bench, Tim, demonstrably upset with himself.
So the Mountaineers take over at their 28-yard line. You see Harrison getting attention to his foot, rolled over there on that catch he made a few plays ago. Flag is thrown as Zeroway is met at the line of scrimmage and driven back. May not have even gotten to the line of scrimmage. Kerwin Hairston, he's the leader on that front for Virginia Tech, the senior from Martinsville, Virginia. Another of those walk-on players, and now is on scholarship, and he's the main man up there. Don Nealon has to be happy with his first half performance. Mountaineers dominating.
Holding. Offense. 10 yards. Spotted a foul. Replay first down.
Holding call against the Mountaineers.
I think we're going to get 62. Steve Ford trying to get the cutoff block on Kerwin Hairston. He reaches across with that right arm. And when you start to wrap outside the framework of your body, they'll call it every single time.
Ford divides time with Randy Dunnigan to the left guard spot. Mark Planks, the fullback, running hard. Gets back about eight on the play.
sophomore from South Charleston, West Virginia.
Well, that's about as efficient as you get. Last four drives, 70, 21, 68, and a 40-yard field goal. That's not bad, Timmy.
Not bad. No, they have been solid in every department. And Virginia Tech came in here, of course, as a team that, as we said at the beginning of the game, these are two evenly matched squads in terms of talent, the records of each 5-1. Virginia Tech favored, I would think, by most people, or maybe not by all the lawmakers around. Of course, Mountaineers playing at home have that advantage. Smith and Prelo making the stop on Zeroway.
Now this is interesting. How about the two backup quarterbacks warming up right now? You can tell Sorensen is the number two guy because he's got somebody catching for him. Up, they put it.
And John Borowski's number 13, sophomore from Welch, West Virginia. Would you be surprised if they went away from Clark at this point?
Well, they need a spark plug right now, and Clark has not been a very efficient passer, so I wouldn't be surprised if they did go to the freshman Sorensen.
Six, incomplete. Intended for Pat Green.
One of the few bad passes Bolger has thrown today. I've really been impressed with Mark Bolger. I think he's been the major difference in these two teams today. Last year, Chad Johnston, the incumbent quarterback at West Virginia, did not play very well. Today, Bolger's really been a major difference.
Brian Bauman has had to punt only twice so far in the game, or early in the third. Hits it from his 22-yard line. He'll go out of bounds. Johnson waiting for it. Saw it go out at the 26-yard line of Virginia Tech. The 42-yard punt. We'll be back. West Virginia, 27-7.
NASDAQ College Football on CBS is sponsored by Chevrolet Trucks, the most dependable, longest-lasting trucks on the road. MasterCard, the future of money. And by the Kodak Advantix System, a better way to take pictures further.
The Mountaineer, if he could smile, he'd be smiling. His team is up handily here, 27-7, 8:10 to go in the third quarter. Tim Ryan, Mike Mayock, Dave Logan, here at Mountaineer Field, Morgantown, West Virginia. Clark continues at quarterback, play-action pass, and he got hit just as he released the ball. The pressure came from Gary Stills, the junior rush linebacker from Trenton, New Jersey.
Yeah, Stills is just running through and around people. They move him all over. This time he's on the left side. He's going to take on Marcus Parker right here and defeat the block and ultimately get to the quarterback. There he is. He's got a little spy technique, and now he says, I can get there. Makes the hit, impacts the play, and that's what he is. He's an impact player, left side, right side, or middle. He's an impact player.
Clark unable to hit on his last four passes from the shotgun again. Second and 10. Takes another shot. The pass intended for Harrison, and it was Gary Stills again.
Oh, man, is he killing people. They ran a twist. A little stunt underneath. Last time, he's on the left side. Watch what happens. He's on the right side. He's coming underneath, and he's going to get right to the quarterback. Watch what happens. Little stunt. He's going to come back on the other side. Slay goes one way. He comes underneath. They don't pick it up, and he gets right in the jaw of Al Clark.
Clark got the ball off that time, but you know he had Stills' presence very much in mind.
Oh, he's right up in his grill. I mean, he's just taking shots at Al Clark every play. Now he's on the left side. You can't find him.
Third and 10. They are 2 of 9 converting. Clark gets time, going deep. And it is incomplete. Gildersleeve, the intended receiver, he had a chance at that ball.
Oh man. I thought Gary Tompkins fell asleep a little bit there. I mean, I didn't think he had a shot at making this catch.
Sophomore Marcus Gildersleeve, little guy, 5'7", first pass to him today.
Yeah, Gildersleeve flies. Now look what happens here. He's got a chance to make a play. When you're down 27-7, Marcus, catch the football right through the basket. I mean, that looked like James Naismith right there, right through the peach basket.
Close to a blocked punt. Terry back for it, handles it at the 25-yard line, and is hit immediately. Good open field tackle by Lauren Johnson. 48-yard punt. We'll be right back. We're back here at Mountaineer Field. Let's go down to David Logan in the band section.
All right. Thank you very much, Tim. A great award has been bestowed upon West Virginia. They have just won the Sutler Award for the best band in the country. 350 strong. You beat them all out. That's a great feeling.
Yes, it's a great feeling. We got that at homecoming a couple weeks ago against Rutgers. We won that game. We got the best band in the country here, and it's a great bunch of kids.
All right, now this is Del Posey. You're the field commander, but I hear this band is so good that even an ex-jock like me would be able to direct this band.
You can do that.
Can I do it?
Yeah, you can.
All right, let's go. Let's see what we got here.
One, two, ready, game.
I thought Dave had a little more fun.
I've only had one lesson. What do you think, guys?
Look good to me, Dave.
It's a waste of money, pal.
First down, intended for Ivy. Bulger overthrows. It's second and 10. You need a better baton.
I think Dave is a little more comfortable as a nose guard than he was as a band leader.
Mark Bulger, 12 of 18 at this point, 176 yards. And his team up 27-7. In the third quarter, 7:32 remains. Drop play, zero away, throwing some of that Sanders look.
Able zero away the ball carrier.
30-yard line to the 31. Engelberger made the stop. Let's go to Jim Nance in New York.
All right, Tim. Tell Dave Logan this is how you strike up the band. The UCLA Bruins playing at home in the Rose Bowl. Caden McNown rolling out. Off balance release. James McElroy is there for the touchdown. McNown on that pass became the all-time passer in UCLA history. Let's go back to West Virginia.
UCLA, pretty good-looking football team this season.
Ball is at West Virginia 32.
The Z-man is the man here. Amos Zeroway, number 20 for the Mountaineers, and he cuts it back to the other side. In this direction and stopped at the line of scrimmage. Tech reading that one. Nate Williams and Steve Tate waiting for him right at the line.
Yeah, I enjoyed talking with Amos yesterday. Take a look at his numbers. 149 yards a game, all-purpose yards, 154. We talked about the 10-0 numbers when he runs for over 100, but I liked his quiet assurance yesterday, Tim, when we spoke with him. I felt he had a confidence about him. Wasn't cocky, but very, very confident that he was one of the top running backs in the country.
Bauman will have to punt standing at the 18.
Got it.
It's blocked. Bounces at the 5-yard line, out of bounds. Carpenter gets his hands on it there. And it was Phillip Summers.
Yep.
He got a hand on it, number 8. Carpenter is usually in there, was right at the ball, but after it was blocked by his teammate Summers. So Frank Beamer knows how to get this done. Gets it done here.
Number 8, Phillip Summers, got underneath. There was a horrible attempt at a block by number 49 for West Virginia, Anthony Green. Carpenter chases it out of bounds, but that's Frank Beamer's 56th block kick in 120 games. He does it as well as anybody. Here comes the hurry up.
First down from the 6-yard line, a flag it off. The Geese is hit hard inside at the line of scrimmage by Hadley, the linebacker number 52.
This Tech offense just has not gotten untracked all day today. Great hit by Hadley, but the flag down, and I think there was some movement again by Tech.
No sign yet from the officials.
Well, they're talking to West Virginia. It's going to be an offside, I believe.
Illegal motion. Offense. Penalty refused. Second down.
Good job. Hadley fills the hole, makes a huge hit on the running back, the Geese that time. Very unusual for a Ricky Bussell coached offensive team to be this inefficient.
The ball at the 8-yard line, second and goal, Virginia Tech. Trail by 20. Need a score here. The Geese slipped. He wasn't going anywhere anyway. But he's at the 10-yard line. Loss on the play of 2.
Now let's put it this way. That front 4 and really the front 7 of West Virginia has dominated this football game.
They've given up only 18 points a game. Last year's number 1 team in NCAA college football on defense. Well coached and well played.
Yeah, last year they had it going big time. Now this is a situation They've got to put the ball in the end zone. I look at this as four down territory here.
Third down and goal. Play action pick. Clark gets sacked. Of the game.
Cogdell came on a delayed blitz. I'm telling you, Steve Dunlap has got the whole package here at West Virginia. Here's Cogdell. He's going to hang, and then burst right through the hole. Watch what happens. He's looking. Now, I know who's got the football. I'm going to get you, Al. Textbook tackle.
Field goal try upcoming by Graham, Shane Graham. And it is good from 33 yards out. And Tech is finally able to get some points to make it 27-10. 4:24 to go in the third.
After a field goal by Virginia Tech.
Kick off to the goal line. Brought back by Nate Terry. And Terry gets to the 25-yard line where he's pushed out there.
Jimmy Kibble, the kicker, actually put a good hit on him, and we're going to have another flag down.
Flag on the kickoff play. There's Kibble, number 95. He's coming back on the field like he's expecting to do something else, and you can see he's holding his left arm. He got in that tackle, and he's hurt. Penalty was against Virginia Tech.
Wow, I think they're going to get him for piling on there, but that was a big shot Kibble took on the sidelines.
After the play was over, personal foul on the kickers, 15 yards from the end of the run, first down.
Beamer not happy, but let's go back to the previous series and the sack by Damon Cogdill. He comes loose late. Good hit right there, buries him in.
First down, meanwhile, for the Mountaineer. And Zeroway slips out the right side and has a first down to the 46-yard line of Tech. Carpenter finally tripped him up.
They call this isolation for a reason, and this time the fullback right here. Watch the block he gets on the linebacker that opens up the hole. That's number 49, Anthony Green. The big block on Steve Tate. The battle of the 49s won by Green. And then you get Amos in the secondary. And, man, that's just poetry in motion.
Zeroway, 127 yards on 23 carries. The sixth 100-yard game of the season. 11th of his two-year career. Not even 2 years yet. Zeroway again. He's got a huge hole. He gets inside the 40. Nate Williams tripped him up there.
Just chewing him up on both sides of the line of scrimmage.
Zeroway slow to get up here. Amos Zeroway might be exhaustion. That's what Mountaineer fans hope that, that it is. But he was hit by the big man, Nate Williams, the tackle.
I don't know if he's tired. He's used to carrying the ball 25 or 30 times a game, but this Virginia Tech defense will just come after you and come after you. I think he's okay.
24 carries for Zeroway up to 136 yards. And remember, he came in with a quad muscle that's troubling him.
He's got the latest in headwear there. He's got the color-coordinated do-rag. I think he's okay, Tim. It looked like the end of the run. He puts his head down, trying to run through tacklers. He's got two people. I think the ball and the two people on top of his stomach. He probably just lost exactly.
Yeah, I think so. He kind of ate that ball right into his belly, and he had big Nate Williams on top of him. It goes about 275, so he earned a rest anyway.
If you've never landed on a football.
Ouch.
Yeah, exactly. It's really painful.
Second and two. Curtis Keith has come in to replace him, number nine. Play action fake to him, and the pass caught by Ivy. What a strike by Bulger. The Corey Ivy, Lauren Johnson made the tackle. Well, Don Nealon thinks he's got himself quite a quarterback here, and he just saw one go to the pros in Druckenmiller.
He thinks this guy, by the time he's a senior, is in the same category.
Watch what happens when we talked about play action. Everybody's going to flow hard this way, and then you get the one-on-one look because there's no free safety in the hole. Good job by Bolger. Defense flows with him towards play action. One-on-one, no free safety. That's just a great pitch and a great catch. Good job by Corey Ivey and Mark Bolger.
Four catches for Ivey, 51 yards on the game. This is the fullback, Anthony Green, number 49, a sophomore from Jersey City, New Jersey. Got a couple. Let's go to our reporter, Dave Logan, again. Dave.
All right, Tim. Just want to get you caught up on Amos Zuraway. Just had the wind knocked out of him. He should be back in the game any moment. Back to you.
Well, that'll teach him to eat footballs with his stomach.
He missed the pregame.
Carrying heavy gun on top of him.
Double tight end, balanced set. They can go either way out of this. Power either way.
Short drop, Bulger on the left side. Drop this time by Ivey. Johnson on the coverage. Hit him as soon as the ball arrived, and Corey Ivey could not hold on.
And you know what? Johnson had a chance to make a play there because it bounced out of Ivy's hands right up into Johnson.
Zeroway back in the ball game.
Can't see him there behind all the big fellas. There he is.
He came from the Ivory Coast as a child with his father, Bunday, who is a commercial photographer. Played his high school football in Long Island. Broke all of Jim Brown's records there. He's a late recruit. After he finally got his SAT scores where he needed them, West Virginia drafted. Other teams had looked at him earlier, but it was West Virginia who waited him out, and he is a happy young man here. That's Foreman, incomplete, unable to hold on to that. That'll bring up fourth down.
That's a nice drive by West Virginia. We're down to a minute 54 left in the third quarter. About a 39-yard attempt here. Virginia Tech's got to make another play on special teams.
Field goal try of 39. And it is good. Jay Taylor. He is 3 of 3 on the day. 44, 20, and 39. Mountaineers continue to click in every single category, and they lead 30 to 10.
Tim, at some point, this Virginia Tech defense has got to step up and make a play. They can't just allow West Virginia to match them field goal for field goal or play for play. When you're down by 20 points, you got to stop the other team before you win the game.
Charlton is the deep man, number 3, near the goal line. Taylor will kick it off. Batting 1,000 in the field goal kicking department today. A good deep kick off to Dandy. Drives it halfway back into the end zone. He will not bring it up. Three yards and 7 plays for West Virginia with a field goal by Taylor. And the home team playing with a lot of confidence. Both these clubs coming in here at 5-1. Virginia Tech unbeaten in the Big East at 4-0. Facing their first defeat in the Big East unless they can rally here with 1:45 to go in the third quarter.
Very difficult to rally without your deep threat, Sean Scales. He's their vertical threat, and they also have Angelo Harrison with a foot problem. So they're really battling back from a position of weakness.
And the Mountaineer defensive front just continues to dominate. Green and Williams, the safety and the linebacker, Jason Williams, number 44, coming up to stop Oxendine in his tracks. Oxendine only 29 yards now on 13 carries.
Now you've got 3, 5, 7, and there's two other guys edging up outside for West Virginia late, just prior to the snap. You've got 8, almost 9 people within the tackle-to-tackle role. You can't run the ball. It's just you're outnumbered at the point of attack.
Alcock from the shotgun. Runs out of time and is sacked again. Henry Slade.
That's my point. On first and 10, West Virginia's geared up for run. Virginia Tech runs the ball, they get killed. Now it's second long, you've got to throw the ball, and they're bringing the kitchen sink. Watch what happens here. Henry Slay, number 78, is going to get a great push on the guard. Beats him inside. There's a little twist. Slay comes underneath.
Henry Slay, the senior from Elyria, Ohio. Fourth sack. Third and 17. Clark deep. Down the sideline, it's out of bounds. Bastien had the coverage on Ken Handy. Another flag down out at the 40-yard line, away from the play. May have been a push on another receiver downfield. 12 seconds remains here in the third quarter.
Defensive hold.
Holding is the call. It was away from the ball, but on another receiver downfield in the pattern. Clark has shown he's got great arm strength, no doubt about that.
Holding. Defense. 10 yards from the line of scrimmage. Automatic first down.
That's the key to that. Anytime holding offensive, that defensive holding is always an automatic first down. So third and 17, even though it's only a 10-yard penalty, that becomes a first down. And that's a big play in this game.
So the Hokies get a little bit of help there with a miscue finally by the Mountaineers. Defensive holding. First down. 23-yard line. Oxendine running straight ahead. They've had very little success running between the tackles.
Especially on first down when they're jumping into that eight-man front.
And the gun sounds to end the third quarter with the score. West Virginia 30, Virginia Tech 10. We'll return to Mountaineer Field right after this message and a word from your local station. Tim Ryan, Mike Mayock, David Logan. It is 30-10 for West Virginia at home against Virginia Tech. Tech has got to make something happen as we open the fourth quarter, second and 8. Tech to our left in white at their own 25-yard line. You can see those 24 points in that second quarter, the scoring difference in this game. They just completely whipped up on Tech, rolling up 24 points. Spark has some time and it's batted down at the line of scrimmage. Boy, he has had everything happen to him today. Only one interception, that came at the half, but he has been sacked four times, now has one batted down. Brings up third down.
Gary Stills again. This time, two-point stance, same stunt. He's going to come around, tackle comes out. When he doesn't get to the quarterback, he does the smart thing. He elevates. Look at him. They pick him up. DiNapoli does a good job. He sees the ball being thrown, and he elevates.
Clark, deep sideline, headed for Michael Stewie, and that is incomplete. The coverage was Dave Lightcap, number 35. They're in their dime package. Six DBs on the field for West Virginia.
Watch Stills elevate here. Look at this. This is a rush linebacker, folks. It hits him right in the face mask. He has his elbow up above the rim on that one. Wow.
6'6", 235 pounder. Stewie, the intended receiver on the last play, helped to the sideline, and that punt is partially blocked, but it's now waved
no
out
play.
The whistle blew. No
wow.
play.
Oh,
holy smokes.
Wow. What was that? They said timeout had been called.
Timeout!
I'm out West Virginia.
Well, Jerry Porter didn't call timeout. He was in blocking the punt.
Oh, man.
Number two, Porter got a hand on that. Look at Don Nealon saying, hey, what's going on here, lads? Fortunately, they're in front.
Somebody trying to get off?
We're back here in Mountaineer Field, and evidently the Mountaineers are trying to call a timeout. They may have had one too many men on the field, but the officials didn't see that. They had the punt partially blocked by Jerry Porter. But meanwhile, Virginia Tech gets another chance because a timeout was called by West Virginia.
And don't forget, in their only loss of the season against Miami of Ohio from the MAC conference, Virginia Tech had two punts blocked.
Kibble back at his 12-yard line.
Hits it from the 17.
And it's a dandy. Backs up Terry all the way to the 10-yard line. He bobbled it momentarily.
Terry gets up to the 20. Another flag flies.
On the return, Nate Terry, number 28, got it to the 20-yard line of West Virginia. 58-yard punt. Kibble nailed a 66-yarder earlier, also had a 12-yarder that led to Zeroway's touchdown in the second quarter that made it 24-7.
Take it back half the distance, back to the 10-yard line now. And a lot of things going Virginia Tech's way so far, but they can't seem to take advantage.
Penalty against the Mountaineers.
On the return, illegal block in the back. Receivers. Half the distance to the goal, spot a foul. First down.
So the Mountaineers will start from their 10 with 14:33 remaining in regulation time, and they lead 30-10. To go regulation time. West Virginia leads 30-10. Tim Ryan, Mike Mayock, and David Logan here at Mountaineer Field. And West Virginia takes the field with a first down at their 10-yard line.
Kennedy setting them back following the punt. Zeroing nowhere to go that time. Swarm down,
led by Steve Tate and Ike Charlton. Let's go to Dave Logan on the field.
All right, thanks, Tim. I am joined now by John Junker, the executive director of the Fiesta Bowl. And John, and I guess in about maybe six more weeks, you'll have to go ahead and make that decision. What exactly are you looking for this year in the Fiesta Bowl?
You know, Dave, at the Tostitos Fiesta Bowl, we've really been lucky to build a game that players and coaches really enjoy. And the enthusiasm factor is very important. It's important for us this year to have teams that bring lots of enthusiastic fans to Tempe.
All right, you've been watching West Virginia this afternoon. They could possibly be in the Fiesta Bowl. What do you think about them?
Very, very impressive game today. They look a lot better than 20th. You know, the last 3 years, Virginia Tech's been one of the four best teams in the country in terms of total victories. West Virginia's made quite a statement. We're very impressed.
What other teams out there could you consider a contender for this bowl?
Oh, there's probably still about 10 or 11 in the running teams all over the country. The next 3 weeks or so will start to figure that out, but we're due for a great game on the New Year's Eve evening.
All right, and we'll see you at the end of the year on CBS.
Looking forward to it, Dave.
All right, thank you, John. Tim.
All right, Dave, we've got a third down and 10 now. 2 yard loss, a 2 yard gain. They're back at the 10 yard line. Baldwin leads him out. They ask him. Baldwin pumps once, and then it's picked off. The flag goes down, taken into the end zone by Bastien. Ike Charlton, but a flag down,
yeah.
Upfield.
That's going to come back because they knocked the intended receiver down while the ball was in the air. They're going to call pass interference and bring it back.
Another miscue by the Hokies. Charlton's touchdown return wiped out. Here's the call.
Interference. Defense. Spotted a foul. Automatic first down.
Bulger wanted to throw the football. He was forced to bring it back down. You see the near side receiver get knocked down right about here when Bulger attempts to throw the football. He's double teamed. They're really not, you see, the ball's not in the air yet. That is not pass interference. Remember, this is college football. You're allowed to contact the receiver as long as the ball's not in the air.
On the left side to Zeroway gets to the 25-yard line, picked up about 3. Charlton made the tackle, number 3.
You know, this is not pro football. Pro football, there's that 5-yard bump rule.
Right.
In college football, you can contact the receiver anywhere on the football field as long as the ball's not in the air. That particular play, clearly the ball is not in the air. I don't think that's interference. Here you go again, right here. And take a look up top and see if the football's in the air. The arm by Prelo knocks him down. The ball's never in the air. I don't think that's interference, and that should be a touchdown.
Bulger was waiting for him to clear. That's why he pumped when he saw him go down. Second down.
Bulger out the right side has a first down. That's complete to Sean Foreman, number 16. Gotta like the poise of the sophomore quarterback.
Now, we just had the interview with Mr. Junker of the Fiesta Bowl. Here's what happens in the Big East. The first choice in the Big East goes to the Alliance Bowl, and that's number 4 against number 6 if it happens to be the Fiesta Bowl. Then the Gator Bowl gets a choice of the second Big East team, CarQuest Bowl, the third Big East team, and if a fourth Big East team has 6 Division 1A wins, they'll play the champion of the Conference USA.
West Virginia, as Mr. Junker said, making a statement here today with his performance so far against Virginia Tech. Zellaway squirts through, picks up about 8. Charlton makes the tackle.
I'm so impressed by the strength of Amos Zellaway. Only about 5'9", but watch 200 pounds. Watch him move and push the pile here. Here comes the hole off left guard. Look at right here, and then he's going to make a decision and watch him drag some people through. Takes the first hit right at the point of attack from 280-pound Kerwin Hairston and still picks up 7 yards.
He's up to 28 carries and is approaching his season average. He's got 148. He averages 149.3. Leroy White gets the carry trying to get the first down.
Look at Leroy. Now, he's been knocking down linebackers all day. So what they do is they throw him a bone every now and then, Tim. It's okay. You knock down 12 more linebackers and you'll get another carry.
And they got a first down, too. Leroy White, senior fullback from Washington, D.C.
Now, Amos is used to outrushing entire teams. And take a look at them today. 172 yards. Tech, as a team, only has 121. Folks, that's not an unusual statistic for him.
Bulger. That's complete to Corey Ivey. Took quite a lick. Kept on ticking.
I really like Corey Ivey, what he does for this team, but I'm really impressed more than anybody today with Mark Bulger. He's delivering the football on time. He's got an understanding of what this offense is trying to do. And when you've got a tailback like Amos, you keep faking the ball. That takes the pressure or puts the pressure on the linebackers. The deep curl route right in the gut, and Corey Ivey does the rest.
His fifth catch, he's got 68 yards and took a hard hit from Jamel Smith and just popped right back up.
Sure did.
First down. Zellaway straightened up by Steve Tate. Maybe a loss on the play and a flag down on the play.
Bulger, remember, he's a first-year starter, so the first two games, the numbers aren't quite as good, but look how he's come on the last four games. 62%. I love 8 touchdowns versus only 2 interceptions in the last 4 games.
Holding. Offense. 10 yards. Spotted a foul. Replay. First down.
That backs it up to the 45-yard line. He's such a calm, poised young man. You got to believe that the genes have got something to do with it. His relationship with his father, Jim, a former quarterback at Notre Dame behind Joe Theismann in those days.
Right.
And I'm sure they talk a lot of football. And this youngster had an outstanding high school career in Pittsburgh, Dan Marino's old school. Close to 4. Steve Tate is there. Let's get an update on the Kentucky-Georgia game from Jim Nance.
All right, thank you, Tim, and watch this. Kentucky's Tim Couch out of the shotgun as team trails by 10. Fourth quarter, finally found Craig Yeast. The extra point was blocked. Kentucky thought it recovered the onside kick, but a penalty gives the ball to Georgia with 2.5 to go. Back to Tim.
That young man born to throw the football, and maybe this young man was too.
I like it because he looks like he's been here before,
sure
even though
does.
He's only a one-year starter.
Bulger short drop this time, and he connects to Sean Foreman. Foreman, the Big East leading receiver, having a fine day here today. Prelo made the tackle. Foreman came here as a linebacker, played defensive back, now a wide receiver, looks very comfortable there.
And what I love about the West Virginia wide receivers is, in addition to being fast, they're also large. I mean, you look at Ivy at 6'2", 190, Foreman 6'1", 205. They've had a history of those kind of wide receivers. Rashawn Vanterpool. last year. They've got all kinds of the big, strong, fast guys running around here the last few years.
Pat Green comes in, another big guy, 6'2", 190, wide receiver. Short drop again by Bulger, and it's picked up. That is Charlton. Well, Charlton had one call back, and Charlton this time comes up with a clean pickoff that'll stand up. No flags are down.
Great job, because I think the ball was deflected, and it just was a gift to Charlton. Let's see what happens here. Third down, it's a three-step drop by Bulger. One, two, three, throw the football. Yep, clearly a deflection. It looked like, I think, number 77, Carl Bradley. And then a good job by Charlton getting as much as he could. And now here's a situation. They've got to capitalize on the big play.
Only the fourth interception of the season suffered by Bulger. 8:59 remains, fourth quarter.
Off the quarterback in the shotgun at the 40-yard line. A West Virginia hit from behind. The ball is loose. And let's see what they rule.
It's live. They haven't blown the whistle.
They never blew the whistle.
Yeah,
I didn't think so either. Tech thought the player played it like it was a dead ball. Kevin Landall put the lick on Clark.
That was an incredible play, one you hardly ever see, and that's why coaches say you've got to play to the whistle. The Virginia Tech people anticipated a whistle that didn't happen. Watch what happens now. His arm is trying to come forward. Now, they're calling that a loose ball, okay? And number 15, Gildersleeve, picks it up.
But he played it like the ball was dead, and it was still alive. Lucky he picked it up.
There's a loss on the play, and Clark now on second down. Marcus Parker, the fullback, hit immediately.
See, what happens is Gildersleeve, it bounces right up into his hands, and he doesn't know that the ball's still live. He anticipated a whistle that didn't happen. He picks it up. Look at him. He's just standing there. That's a great play by Steve Lippi, number 50, and then a smart play by Clark. He never heard the whistle, so, man, you got to get on it and play it live.
Leaves him third down and 16.
Clark waiting, and then he's off the mark trying to get it to Oxendine.
For more on Kentucky, Georgia, let's go back to New York and Jim Nance.
Well, Timmy, right after that failed onside kick, watch what happened for Georgia. From the 44-yard line, Robert Edwards, this is untouched, 44 yards. His second big romp of the day at an 80-yard run earlier. Let's go back to Tim and Mike.
Robert Edwards, good looking back for the Bulldogs.
Fourth down.
And they're going to go for it here. They pretty much have to. 8:07 to go, down by 20.
Clark is sacked again.
Good coverage downfield, and then Kevin Landolt wrapped him up.
When Steve Dunlap gets that dime package and allows the underneath guys to wind it up and get after the quarterback, they are a brutally tough defensive ball club. They've gotten better every week. Clark has no time, but with fourth and 16, you've got to throw the ball down the football field. A sack does you no good. Throw the ball up in the air, but Landolt bombed to a great job. 30-10, West Virginia.
NASDAQ College Football on CBS is sponsored by Oldsmobile and your local Oldsmobile retailers. Duracell. When it better work, better make it Duracell. And by the NASDAQ stock market.
Which one do you like, Tim?
Well, I'd say that it's a tie for all of those Presley lookalikes here on... We're approaching Halloween.
Here comes sack number 6. Landolt's going to beat the double team by Washington and Vic just because of pure hustle. Watch him. He won't give up. Double team block. They give up on him, but he doesn't give up on Al Clark. Al's got to throw the football. Fourth and 16. Taking a sack isn't helping anybody.
First down at midfield. Mountaineers. Sellout crowd enjoying this performance. Mark Plants, the fullback, number 46, is hit right at the line of scrimmage. It'll be a loss of about a half yard on the play. 30-10, the Mountaineers gaining revenge for the 27-0 shutout at the hands of the Hokies 2 years ago right here.
Look at that number. I mean, that just shows the domination up front. They're beating Virginia Tech in literally every important category. Mark Bulger just sitting back there and pitching and catching, Timmy.
If the Mountaineers hold on to win here, they would move to 3-1 in the Big East. Virginia Tech would fall to 4-1. And we've got a new race. Syracuse still in the mix, of course. Battle today, but 2-1 in the Big East. Notre Dame upset Boston College. You call that an upset only because you're standing next to me. You old eagle, you.
I knew I was going to hear that. But exactly what you were just referring to, if West Virginia holds on the win, the rest of the Big East, which they're rooting for, then all of a sudden, everybody's got one loss up top there. And next week's game with Syracuse takes on critical importance. West Virginia next Saturday night at Syracuse.
Third and about 12.
I knew you were going to bring up that Notre Dame score.
Well, I tried to make you feel a little bit better.
I mean,
listen, my squad, Domers, have been struggling here, so we'll take anything we can get, even against BC.
As far as I'm concerned, they're the Boston College of the Midwest.
Third and 12. Plants again, Mark Plants, and struggling back near the original line of scrimmage.
How fickle is this crowd? It's 30-10. Your team has just played an unbelievable game. Don Nealon's coaching his tail off. And aside from the fact they're leaving, they're booing him for running the ball on 3rd and 12.
Well,
I
don't understand the booing, but the folks leaving, I can understand trying to beat the traffic. It's a little difficult to get out of here. High short punt by Bauman. Let's see what bounce it takes, and it does for the Mountaineers. Inside the 20, inside the 15. That turned out just fine for West Virginia. Lauren Johnson didn't bother to pick that one up, and it rolls inside the 15. 5:51 to go. The Mountaineers 30, the Hokies 10. Well, here at Mountaineer Field, 30-10, the home team by 20 over Virginia Tech. 5:51 to go. Stay with us tonight on CBS. It's America's Night of Television. Tune in for Dr. Quinn, Medicine Woman, followed by Early Edition, and Walker, Texas Ranger, all tonight on CBS. The Hokies start from their 14-yard line. Now Clark continues at quarterback. It's been a tough day for him. 6 times he's been sacked. And Clark showing that arm he's got downfield to win out of bounds for Gilbert. Even take out somebody on the sidelines, a bench, and a defender. The defender was Barrett Green, number 33.
That's tough duty when you make coverage like that, and then you got to run over a bench and into people and try. It's a fight just to get back to the field.
Clark is now one of his last 11 passing.
Look at this. Now, he pushes him a little bit.
No,
there.
He grabbed him, though.
And then he tried to grab him. You're right. And I think they were both.
Yeah, he pushed him and then grabbed him by the shoulder.
Yeah, but they called it. They called it.
Well, he was out of bounds. I think they have to call it, but he did attempt to save him from crashing into the bench. And the student manager, I guess it is, down there.
Look at Don Nealon. We'll talk about a competitor. He's saying, no way. Our guy tried to hold him up. You know, we've had Barrett Green has had several plays like that called already this season. And what they say, he's like a guided missile. You know, they can aim him, and he's going to knock you down. And what they're trying to do is combine it between the white lines.
He had 5 personal fouls in 2.5 games, and he has kind of calmed down. He said, I got my act together and more under control, but control got away from him there. That's complete to Gildersleeve. Marcus Gildersleeve. Pickup of about 6 on the play, maybe a little more. Let's see where they spot it. Well, we'll call it about a 7-yard gain. 5:22 to go. No huddle offense continues for Tech. Clark from the shotgun. That's been played. Ken Handy, wide receiver number 48. And West Virginia rushes on defensive changes. You've got to hustle them on because of the no huddle offense.
Exactly.
They got about 6 guys on. I don't know whether they got all the guys on they wanted to, but they got some of them on.
Well, they got the dime package. They got what they wanted.
Tried to substitute. Clark gets some time. Deep sideline. Intended for Gildersleeve. Overthrown, incomplete. Whitecap had the coverage. May have got a hand on the ball, but it was going to be too long.
We're going to have a hold anyway. They're going to bring it all the way back. The situation, they might even decline that penalty. I'm not sure.
Number 28, Nate Cherry.
Take them back.
Holding. Offense. 10 yards, spotted a foul. Replay, first down.
Back to the 33-yard line of Virginia Tech. Four remaining. And first down, Park steps up from the rush, gets some time. And again, that one overthrown down the sideline, intended for Remley. Brian Remley, number 81, into the ballgame at wide receiver.
Kind of shows you the state of the wide receiver situation right now at Virginia Tech. They came into the game without Scales. Then they lose Stewie. Angelo Harrison had a foot injury. They're down to Gildersleeve, Handy, and Remley. A couple of those guys weren't even on the depth chart when the season started.
Second down and 23. Inside handoff to Marcus Parker. Parker breaks a tackle. Keeps going. Good effort by Parker. Gets to the 45-yard line before Barrett Green pulled him down.
Carrying the ball. The initial stop was made by number 33, Barrett Green.
Marcus Parker, a fullback, actually a tailback. Great runner. Learned to block a little bit better.
Nearly picked off, knocked down by the rush of Bob Baum, number 45, the defensive end.
All right, Bob Baum.
Oh, he saw goal line there, defensive end. Had he been able to steal that ball, he'd be in the end zone.
Give Steve Dunlap some credit. They're still going all out. That was a free safety blitz that time. He's up 30-10, and he's still bringing the kitchen sink.
.4:17 remaining in regulation time. West Virginia up by 20, and Virginia Tech with a 4th and 12 will have to go for it at their own 44-yard line. Al Clark lets it fly downfield, and it is overthrown, too far for Marcus Gildersleeve.
Oh,
a flag down there, the 15-yard line.
I don't get that one.
Gildersleeve might have been the offender. Let's see, they're talking to him. He may have grabbed the defender.
Yeah, they're going to get, I think, Charles Fisher, number 4, on a hold.
Now there's a discussion back at the 45-yard line now with the referee.
We have no play, no flag, downfield. Dead ball. False start.
I think what they did is they picked up the flag down the field because they're going to rule that the receiver couldn't catch the football anyway. So that's why they picked that flag up, and they go back to the previous flag at the line of scrimmage.
Well, it's going to leave 4th and 17. Al Clark, his first season at quarterback, is the starter. Sidesteps one of the rushers. He's got a man open, Handy, number 48. The junior wide receiver from Arlington, Virginia, and he gets the first down inside the 40, a 22-yard pass play. A long day for Al Clark, but he's hanging in there. 3:58 to go. Quick look at the scoring summary. A field goal opened it for West Virginia. Ken Handy caught a 12-yard touchdown pass for Mark Bulger. It's 15 of 25 on the day, 217 yards, the sophomore quarterback. That is Lamont McGee's. Transfer from Clemson, picking up close to 4. Going back to our scoring summary, Sean Foreman caught a 46-yard touchdown strike from Bulger. That made it 10-7. Still in the second quarter, where they scored 24 points, Bulger took it in on a 1-yard dive, and then Amos Zeroway has been the hero today, scored from 3 yards out. Zeroway has 153 yards rushing on 29 carries. Over his season average. Clark on second down. That's complete to Gildersleeve.
to about the 31. And just before halftime, Taylor scored the second of his three field goals from 20 yards out. That made it 27-10. Tech got a field goal back from Graham in the third quarter from 33 yards, and then Taylor's third from 39 yards out made it 30-10. We have a timeout down on the field. Al Clark goes to the sideline with 2:58 to go. It's been West Virginia all the way. 2:58 remains. West Virginia leads 30-10 over Virginia Tech. Earlier you saw with Jim Nance and company, Robert Edwards scoring a touchdown run for Georgia. Well, next week you'll see him with quarterback Mike Bobo leading number 16 Georgia against the Florida Gators. The classic SEC matchup, Georgia-Florida, next Saturday at 3:30 Eastern on NASDAQ College Football on CBS. And Coach Steve Spurrier will have to be ready for the Bulldogs next Saturday at 3:30 Eastern.
And that's two of the most creative offenses in the country. That Georgia offense is so multiple. It's so much fun to watch with Hines Ward, Mike Bobo, Edwards. That's going to be a lot of fun.
Third down and two for Virginia Tech. In the shotgun again, Clark. Clark, deep corner. Good coverage all the way down the field.
Great coverage.
Perlo Bastine right with his man. That was handy. And so it is fourth down. Well, you can see what's going on in the SEC. That's the game we just talked about, Florida, Georgia.
Yeah, there's the key. Let's stay right here. These two teams play next week. Whoever wins that football game has the head up on the Eastern Division of the SEC for the SEC championship.
Virginia Tech with a fourth and two. They've tried twice. They made two out of four previous attempts on fourth down here. They go this time into the I formation. And it is Pegues. Pegues, the spin move, gets him close to the first down. He appears to have it. Lamont Pegues.
First down, Virginia Tech.
Pretty interesting.
Tompkins and Stills there.
Talking about that Eastern Conference race in the SEC. Remember, Tennessee's already beat Georgia. If Georgia was able to upset Florida, it would throw things way out of whack there in that SEC East, huh?
Sure would. And, you know, we've got now a similar situation here. If West Virginia prevails, looks like they're going to. Suddenly a new race in the Big East. That one dropped. Ken Handy couldn't hang on.
Oh, boy. Next week, the Carrier Dome will be rocking. Syracuse with one loss in the Big East, hosting West Virginia, who will also have one loss at that point. Bowl implications, and all they've got left after that is Temple and Pitt, two very winnable games within the conference for West Virginia.
Virginia Tech has Miami and Pittsburgh remaining in the Big East on their schedule. Both teams at 5-1 coming into the game. Clark running it this time. Down to the 17-yard line where he's hit by Gary Tompkins, number 11. Al Clark still scratching and clawing here. It's been a long, hard day for him. Six times he's been sacked. Got his passing numbers up to 12 of 29 for 116 yards.
Now let's not forget he's also a first-year starter. Sat behind Druckenmiller 2 years in a row. This is kind of the first time he's really been in the cauldron this year against a real fine defense. A defense that took the rushing attack away and forced him to try and win the football game.
They are minus nine rushing in this second half, Virginia Tech. And, you know, with the likes of Oxendine and Marcus Parker and Lamont Pegues, that was their strength coming into the game.
And I give a lot of credit to Steve Dunlap because they, Bill Krulevich, all the Jerry Holmes, the defensive back coach. West Virginia's defense has gotten better and better each week. They're not as good as they were a year ago, but let's face it, they've got five guys in the NFL from that defense.
He's down 27-7, had to throw the ball in this second half, deep to the corner, and that is incomplete. Intended for Renly. Fisher, number four, junior from Aliquippa, Pennsylvania, had the coverage. Well, following the conclusion of our game, we'll be going to our post-game show in New York. Jim Nance, Craig James, Lou Holtz will be on hand to bring you up to date on all of the stuff that's been going on today in college football.
Fourth down. Now changing up, Al Clark changing the play as defensive West Virginia jumping around, making it even more confusing. Pegues, the ball carrier.
Now, time will stop while they reset the chains, and Al Clark's got to get his guys back over the ball, but we've got an injury. Parker up slow.
1:54 counting down now under the 1:50 mark. First down at the 15-yard line of West Virginia. It's been a Mountaineer day. That'll get them to 3-1 in the Big East. That will fall to 4-1. Here's Pegues on the pass, and Pegues driving hard down to the 2-yard line.
Lost the football, but either way, it's Virginia Tech's ball, either whether he was down by contact, but it was recovered also by Virginia Tech. Here he comes. There's the strip. That's a fumble. That is absolutely a fumble, but Pegues jumps on it. Also, another one of their wide receivers, might have been Remley, jumped on top.
Cogdell put the hit on him, and that jarred the ball loose. First and goal, Tech. Pegues trying to dive, but he was way too far back to make that leap.
Let's see where he tries to elevate from. The ball's on about the 1.5 yard line. The handoff is at the 3.5 yard line. If nobody was there, he might not have scored.
Carl Lewis would have had a tough time getting into the end zone from there.
That was about a 19-foot long jump.
Lippe and Barrett Green made the tackle. Steve Lippe. 1:10 on the clock.
Now, it's not all over for Virginia Tech. They go out of conference with UAB next week, but then they've got to come back and host Miami and Pittsburgh in the Big East before their big non-conference tilt day after Thanksgiving. So they've got to hang in there and regroup. This is the best team they've played so far this year. Frank Beamer knows that. They're still right in the thick of it.
Tech ranked 19 by the AP coming into the game. Tech with one timeout remaining. West Virginia with two. 1:10 on the clock. 20-point lead. West Virginia simply dominated on both sides of the ball today.
Well, there's Bill Kurlevich, Steve Dunlap. They've been around here a long time. Two of the better defensive coaches you'll find anywhere.
And these Mountaineer fans wanting the Hokies to be stopped again. Clark wants to throw, wide open in the end zone, touchdown to the tight end, Sullivan. Sean Sullivan, and yet another flag down.
Sean Sullivan.
The tight end sneaking into the corner of the end zone. He was left all alone back there, and Clark calmly found him.
That will be a touchdown, offside West Virginia.
Defense, penalty refused, touchdown.
He could have thrown this football at any point because Sullivan was wide open on the play action. He's going to sneak out after the slow block. Clark should have thrown it there, but he's fortunate he still had enough time. Nobody's anywhere near tight end Sean Sullivan.
1 yard touchdown pass for the score. Second touchdown pass by Clark. He hit earlier with Ken Handy. Point after attempt by Shane Graham. And it is good. So with 1:04 to go, West Virginia now leads 30-17 over the Hokies of Virginia Tech. Let's go to Jim Nance in New York.
All right, Tim, an SEC game just getting started. Auburn at Arkansas. Razorbacks with the ball and the fumble picked up by the Auburn Tigers, who lead Western Division. Fumble recovery gives them 10-0 lead second quarter. And let's go back to Tim and Mike.
Thank you, Jim. 1:04 remains here as we've been under the lights actually all day long, but that was because of cloudy skies, and we're now under darkness here. The lights at Mountaineer Stadium. Well, don't forget, next Saturday, it's number 16 Georgia, number 6 Florida. Jacquez Green, the exciting receiver. Steve Spurrier's highfalutin offense, and Mike Bobo, an outstanding young quarterback with Georgia, leading the Bulldogs.
Yeah, 3:30 Eastern. If you like offense, Tim, that's one to tune in on. But here's a situation. 18-play, 85-yard drive. Very impressive for Tech. obviously an onside situation. West Virginia's got their hands team on the field. Five guys up front, four guys right behind them, one deep safety. They actually have five and five with one deep safety. All the good skill position players up tight.
Onside kick attempt, and it is grabbed by Foreman, Sean Foreman, the wide receiver, one of those hands you talked about. Those are good hands to have.
And he's showing them for everybody. There they are. Give me a touch. Take a little of these. There you go.
Foreman had a fine day here.
Sure did. That's a good football. You know what happens sometimes, Tim? You take a situation where Saunders, their all-conference wide receiver, goes down, and you know what happens is they pull together, and a guy like Foreman steps up another level, and then they get Corey Ivey that steps it up that probably wouldn't have had an opportunity had that not happened.
There's Mark Bulger. Got a little bandage on his chin there. He must have taken a shot somewhere along the game.
Well, he didn't get hit as much as Al Clark, but somebody got up underneath his cage and rattled him a little bit.
And so it is Juwan Sider just closing out the clock time here at quarterback for West Virginia.
Bud Foster, the defensive coordinator, not giving up. He called for a timeout there. Look, they still got that look in their eyes. That's the way coaches are.
56 seconds remain with West Virginia leading 30-17. 56 seconds remain. You're looking at the winning quarterback here, Mark Bulger from West Virginia, the sophomore. Passing at 60%, had another fine afternoon today and leading his Mountaineers to victory over the 19th-ranked Virginia Tech Hokies. Juwan Sider in there just to count things down, burying the ball with 50 seconds and counting down. Sider, a little quarterback sneak, got about a yard.
He's in the book.
More fun to go forward.
They're all line drives in the book, man.
That's right.
Don Nealon, Frank Beamer. You want to talk about a juxtaposition right there. One guy excited, thinking ahead towards Syracuse. The other guy saying, man, we got to re-get it going again for UAB next week.
Amos Zaraway, 153 yards, over his average of 149.3, 29 carries today, leading the rushing attack of the Mountaineers. Fifth best rusher in the NCAA. You'll hear a lot more from that young man. And that'll do it. The Mountaineers have defeated the Virginia Tech Hokies, breaking a three-game losing streak to their rivals from Blacksburg. Happy day for Don Nealon and company, and a sellout crowd of nearly 65,000 here at Mountaineer Stadium, Morgantown, West Virginia. And the students stream onto the field to celebrate with their team. Let's go downstairs now to Dave Logan.
All right, Tim. Coach, first of all, almost 400 total yards of offense. Just a dominating performance this afternoon.
Well, thank you. Our kids did play hard. They played well. Virginia Tech played hard, and they played well. We probably got a little conservative that second half, but we didn't want to do anything stupid. But this was a big win for us.
But your defense finished the game strong as well. They did a great job this afternoon.
Defense was excellent. They did a great job.
All right.
Thank you.
All right, congratulations.
God bless you.
All right, Tim, back to you.
All right, David. Mark Bulger, 15 of 25, 217 yards. For David Logan and Mike Mayock, this is Tim Ryan saying so long from Mountaineer Field, where the West Virginia Mountaineers 30 and the Virginia Tech Hokies 17. Now let's go to Jim Nance in New York.